ম্যাম, শোনা যাচ্ছে না কিছু?
হ্যালো, স্টুডেন্টস আর রিকোয়েস্টেড টু ফলো দি ইউটিউব লিঙ্ক। গুগল মিট ক্যান অনলি হ্যান্ডেল 100 পার্টিসিপেন্টস, সো প্লিজ ফলো আওয়ার ইউটিউব লিঙ্ক। ইট উইল বি সেম অ্যাজ গুগল মিট। Everyone is requested to mute yourself. Please mute yourself. We are waiting for our principal, sir, and I can see he has already joined. Please mute yourself.
Good morning. Good morning, madam.
Good morning, sir. Good morning, sir. And everyone, please mute yourself. Participants, please mute yourself, everyone. Okay. And you are also requested to join our YouTube link. I have already said in the chat box, please join our YouTube link. Okay. Good morning, sir. A very hearty welcome to our group.
Good morning, sir.
Very good morning. Very
sir,
good morning to all of you.
Okay. I'm getting a call. Sir. Call. Sir. Sir, there's so much noise in the background. Students, please join our YouTube link to avoid the noise so that we can speak. Okay, sir, finally we are able to start the meeting. I can see so many participants have joined, so we can, if you allow us kindly to begin, so we can go ahead.
You may start the program.
Okay.
I will be present only for 15 minutes or 20 minutes maximum time. Okay, due to some problems. So otherwise, I will inaugurate the program. I will welcome to all.
Good morning, everyone, once again. Okay, sir.
Okay. Sir. Please. Am I audible?
Yes, sir, you are perfectly audible.
Okay. Yes, sir, you are audible.
Sir. No problem, you may start. You may start.
Once, sir. So, finally, we are proceeding with the meeting, and I would like to request at the beginning of this proceeding, I would like to request our principal, sir, to share his views. And yes, sir, you are audible. And
hello, Sanjayita madam. Hello. Initially, you may give an introduction of this program, then I may welcome. Okay. You may give an introduction of this program at first, then I will welcome all. As per the norm, you may give an introduction, please. Am I audible? Hello, Sanchita madam.
I can hear you, sir. Actually, there is an echo in the background.
Please give a brief introduction about your program first, please.
Okay, sir. We have after a lot of struggles and difficulties related to the technical. Yes, sir. You are absolutely audible.
Yes. No problem. I have no problem. I am audible.
Sir, finally we are able to arrange a program. This is a webinar for a day actually, but it is a series of lectures, and this is the beginning of our lecture series. And today we are going to have two lectures back to back. First one will be produced by will be delivered by our by the head of Vidyashagar University Department of English, Dr. Jolly Das, and I'm waiting for her. She will join shortly. And the second lecture will be delivered by the reader of Bankura Christian College, Dr. Nadugopal Mukherjee. The first lecture will start shortly from 11 a.m. It is scheduled at 11 a.m. and it will continue up to 12:15. After that, we will have a question and answers section. And after that, the second lecture will continue. And thank you. I would like to thank you for joining us, because I know about the problems that you're going through. And I would also like to express my sincere gratitude to all the people who had supported me to arrange this program, and for which actually I have been able to arrange this. First of all, sir, my chief patron, our principal sir, who is present over here, Dr. Hari Prasad Sarkar, and second, our librarian, Mr. Prolay Bhattacharya, and third, Dr. Abhijit Bhattacharya, who is a member of my advisory committee, and last but not the least, all my colleagues, especially Mr. Prashanto Rakshit, and who has newly joined our department, and second, Polmi Shaha, she has also newly joined our college, and all other staffs, including Mr. Pradeep Mahato and Mr. Tahun Kumar Rana. Thank you, everyone, for helping me in every possible way so that I have finally become able to arrange this program. Now, sir, I would like to request you to address our students and participants. Most of them are basically students, so I can see the registration list, but there are also some other participants from across our nation. There are participants from Tamil Nadu, from Gujarat, from Rajasthan, from Maharashtra, and from Hyderabad, from Delhi, and I'd like to share. I want you to share your views regarding our department and regarding the program. This wouldn't have been possible without your constant assistance and motivation, sir. Especially this is for you, and I am thankful that I'm able to organize this. Thank you very much, sir, for being here. And please, over to you. Please say something.
Hello. Am I audible?
Yes, sir.
Hello. So I am still waiting. Sir. I am still waiting for joining Dr. Jolly Das. I think she has not already joined the program. Please confirm. Sanchayita ma'am, as per your schedule, Dr. Jolly Das will deliver his first lecture.
Am I yes, audible?
Sir, absolutely. So, may I start without our first speaker, Dr. Jolly Das? May I start?
We will join at within two minutes.
So, we may wait a few minutes.
Sir, she will join within 2 minutes.
So, we may wait.
At 11, she has told me she will join only at 11.
So, we may wait for a few minutes for her joining.
So, you can start, she will join. She has joined. Listen, right now she has joined.
Thank you. So, may I start?
Madam has already joined. Madam has already joined.
Okay.
Yes, sir.
Okay, good morning, everybody. It's my great pleasure to welcome all the guests, all the participants in the today's program. In this present COVID-19 pandemic crisis situation, like all other institutions, we also need to continue our academic progress for the student as well as faculty members of our college. With this great endeavor, Department of English, Garbheta College has organized this today's online lecture series in two sessions with two erudite speakers. Today we have Dr. Jolly Das with us. Mm-hmm. Dr. Jolly Das, Associate Professor and Head, Department of English, Vidyasagar University, and also Dr. Narugopal Mukherjee, Leader, Department of English, Bankura Christian College, Bankura. I do express my sincere thanks to our honorable speakers for their kind consent and joining this program. I also thanks to the joint convener of this seminar, Professor Sanchayita Manna, Head of the Department of English, Garbheta College, and also Professor Prashanto Rakshit, Assistant Professor, Department of English, to organize this program. I hope all the participants will be highly benefited and they will be enriched from the lecture of the two erudite speakers. I wish this program a grand success. Wish you all the best. Thank you all. Hello, Sanchayita madam.
Sanchayita madam, please continue.
You may continue.
Yes, sir. I think ma'am is facing some technical problems.
প্রশান্ত বাবু আপনি কন্টিনিউ করে নিন।
আমি আছি, আমি আমি আছি স্যার। অ্যাকচুয়ালি ডিউ টু সাম নেটওয়ার্ক প্রবলেম আই ক্যান হিয়ার।
ইটস ওকে ম্যাম, প্লিজ কন্টিনিউ।
আই ক্যান হিয়ার ইউ স্যার।
ওকে ওকে, ইউ মে কন্টিনিউ, ইউ মে কন্টিনিউ প্লিজ।
হ্যালো, হ্যালো
প্লিজ, ইউ আর অডিবল, ইউ মে কন্টিনিউ।
আইড লাইক টু ওকে thank you sir, thank you sir for your motivating speech, and madam has already joined, so I would like to request before going to madam, I would like to request Prashant, our newest colleague, Mr. Prashant Rakshit, to say a few words. Prashant,
yes, hello, am I audible?
Yes, yes, no problem, you are audible.
Thanks our dear principal sir for such a emotional and such a organizing speech, opening lecture, and our first speaker Dr. Jolly Das has already joined with us, and without doing much ado, I would like to request our head of the department, Dr. Professor Sanchayita Manna, to give a brief introduction to the madam so that we can proceed with our first lecture. Over to you, ma'am, please. Ma'am,
okay, it's nice. Well, ma'am, thank you, thank you Prashant. Now I'd like to request madam to please continue with her lecture, but before starting I'd like to say a few words. Madam, our first resource person for the day, Dr. Jolly Das, who is now working as associate professor and head in the Department of English, Bidyasagar University, has agreed to deliver a speech for our students and participants, and she has 17 years of experience in this field, and her topic for today's discussion is translating Mahashweta Devi's Draupadi, which has been incorporated in the syllabus of 5th semester English Honors, Bidyasagar University. So this lecture, I believe, will not only help the students of our college, but also students, all the students of who have been registered themselves for English Honors under Bidyasagar University. So, madam, I'd request you to kindly proceed with your brief introduction and speech. We are waiting for it. So, over to you, madam. Please join us.
Thank you so much. Sanchayita, can you hear me? Sanchayita, am I audible?
Okay, madam, you are clearly audible, yes. Madam.
Thank you, sir.
Yes. Yes,
before
madam.
I begin, I must say a few words. I must thank Srimati Sanchayita Manna, assistant professor and head department of English, Gaurabinda College, for introducing me. Thank you so much, madam. I express my heartfelt gratitude towards the principal of Gorbeta College, Dr. Hariprasad Sarkar, with whom I have had the privilege of interacting in Vidyasagar University when he was there with us as the controller of examinations. I am glad to meet you, sir. Albeit on a virtual platform. I also thank the other convener of the webinar, Mr. Prashant Rokhit, Assistant Professor in the Department of English, Gorbeta College.
Thank you, ma'am.
One person, thank you, who deserves special thanks for connecting me with the English Department of Gorbeta College is my student at the Women's Study Center, Vidyasagar University, Srimati Poulomi Shah. Thank you, Poulomi, for making this possible for me to be here at Gorbeta College on the virtual platform. What I shall say during the next half an hour or so shall be more of a sharing of my experience of translating Mahashweta Devi's Draupadi from Bengali to English. It is for this reason that I have kept the title of today's discussion that way. I shall divide my talk into the following sections. The first one will be a brief introduction to the author, Mahashweta Devi. The second, on or about the story Draupadi. The third section will be my experience of translating it. And the fourth section will be a very brief conclusion. Now for the first section, Mahashweta Devi's life. Spanning the period between 14th January 1926 and 28th July 2016, which is an interesting period, she has borne witness to the final phase of India's move towards freedom from British rule. She has had the rare privilege of having parents whose cultural backgrounds are exceptionally rich. She has had Rabindranath Tagore as her Bengali teacher when she was a student in class 7 at Shantiniketan, and as a result, her indomitable courage and resilience have enabled her to gather experiences of the rarest nature. She has deliberately chosen to use her powerful narrative skill to write about the underprivileged sections of society, to bring before the readers glimpses of the life and experiences of such ordinary persons who do not possess the material to be part of a narrative. According to the then common practice among creative writers, as recognition of her exceptional contribution to literature, she has been awarded the Sahitya Academy and Gyanpeeth Awards. Besides Indian's civilian awards like the Padma Shri and Padma Vibhushan, which were also conferred upon her, she is popularly known for both her literary work and her social activism, focusing on the marginalized sections of society, particularly the women. The conference of the Raymond Magsaysay Award is acknowledgement of her social activism for the underprivileged Adivasi people, especially the denotified tribe Kheria Shabos, who come under the umbrella of their own organization, the Pashchim Bongo Kheria Shabon Kollan Samiti, based at Rajnoagar, Purulia, of which she was one of the founder members. The author's focus in her creative writings about the Adivasi people has always been on how the natural habitat of the forest-dwelling Adivasis has been encroached upon by interested outsiders whose self-seeking ventures have destroyed the essential living spaces of these people. Outsiders have changed the lifestyle of these people, endangering them and making them respond to the unprecedented situations in a variety of ways. Some have accommodated themselves to the new temptations of abandoning their traditional lifestyle. Others have resisted the encroachments upon their way of life. Life became very complicated for them after the advent of the British in India, as in the case of other Indians. They went forth into every nook and corner, the British, of the subcontinent, leaving no place untrodden, for good or bad. There have been benefits as well as losses of this engagement with such an alien element, an alien culture, an alien oppressive force. Much of this has been documented in literature by way of fictional narratives based on it. Adivasi life could not possibly remain outside this encroachment, and thus the inevitable interface took place. The experiences of Adivasi women is of a different nature. The exploitations that they are subjected to are of overt as well as covert kinds. For example, taking their photographs for marketing globally is a lucrative profession for some photographers. Unaware, they become commodities. This has been explored in one of her stories, Choli Ke Piche, which has been filmed as Gangor in Hindi, and as one of the 13-episode Bengali tele serial by Buddhadev Dasgupta as Choli Ke Piche, translated by Professor Gayatri Chakraborty Spivak in her collection of three breast stories, along with Draupadi and Stanodayi. Their exposure to susceptibility sometimes makes them retaliate in strange but not impossible ways. Having been exploited, even brutalized, they have no option but to lash back in their own ways. The central character of Draupadi is Dobdi Mejen, and Gangor is that of Choli Ke Piche. Mahashita Devi, having spent a long time with the Adivasi people, knew something of the tenacity of the women of these communities. Therefore, both Dobdi and Gangor use their breasts in remarkable, though not exactly in the same, ways. Now to come to the second part, Dobdi Mejen. The author took immense care to build her case to the striking, even unexpected climax of the narrative. Mahashweta Devi's Draupadi, the story, was first published in Ogni Garbho, 1978, which is a collection of stories. I would like to read out to you a very significant section from the introduction to Ogni Garbho. This is in Bangla. Nokshal Barir Ghatonaboli ebong tar prekkhapoter ullekh ekhane mukkhoto amar kahini guli potobhumir proyojone holeo onoshikarjo je e desher koyek doshoker jibonjatray shetai chilo sarbadhik ullekho ebong pranito hobar moto ghotona. Bosai tutu Draupadira esob ghotonari apato hololabh jodio shongrame tarai samaj badol ghatay এবং পরিণামে নাম ও স্থানিক অবস্থান ছাড়িয়ে হয়ে ওঠে কাল ও দেশের প্রতীক। অবশ্য কোন আন্দোলনই হয়তো পন্থা বা পরিণামে শেষ সত্য নয়, একমাত্র ইতিহাসই তার মূল্য নিরূপক। আর চলমান সংগ্রামী মানুষ তাই সর্বদেশে কালে নিজেদের গড়া সমস্ত পথ ভেঙে নতুন পথ গড়ার স্বপ্ন দেখে এবং শপথ নেয়। ইতিহাসের দাম্ভিক গতিপথে সে কারণেই প্রতিনিয়ত উত্তরণের সত্যই সত্য নামে চিহ্নিত হয়। কিন্তু সমস্যা সর্বক্ষেত্রে কেবলমাত্র জমির নয়, ক্ষেত মজুর হিসেবে চাষি তার ন্যায্য পাওনা থেকে বঞ্চিত। জল বীজ ধান সারের জন্য তার নিরন্তর লড়াই, অনাহার ও দারিদ্র্যে তার প্রাত্যহিক দিন যাপন। স্বাধীনতার পর এদেশে যে আর্থনৈতিক অগ্রগতি ঘটেছে তার ফলভোগী হয়নি কোনো মধ্যবিত্ত শ্রমিক ক্ষেত মজুর। একদিকে ধনী শ্রেণী আরো বিত্তবান হয়েছে, সৃষ্ট হয়েছে এক আত্মতৃপ্ত অশিক্ষিত বর্বর নতুন ধনী শ্রেণী, অন্যদিকে সাধারণ মধ্যবিত্ত সামান্য সম্বল হারিয়ে দরিদ্রতর হয়েছে। নিম্নবিত্ত মধ্যবিত্ত শ্রেণী আজ সম্পূর্ণ বিলুপ্তির মুখে, ধনী চাষি আরো ধনী হয়েছে, সামান্য জমির মালিক তার শেষ সম্বল জমিটুকু জোদ্দার মহাজনকে তুলে দিয়ে ক্ষেত মজুরের সংখ্যা বৃদ্ধি করেছে। আর বাঁচার মৌল দাবিও যেখানে তাদের ক্ষেত্রে প্রত্যাখ্যাত, সেখানে শহরে সচ্ছল মধ্যবিত্ত ও উচ্চবিত্তের ভাড়াটেরা সাহিত্যের নামে আপন আপন আত্মানুশীলনে রত। রোম জ্বললে পরে নীরো বেহালা বাজিয়েছেন বটে, তাতে তার অধিকারও ছিল, কেননা যে সকল কারণে রোম জ্বলছিল সেগুলি ভুলে থেকে সবেহালার গুঞ্জনই তার ভালো লাগছিল, কিন্তু পরিণামে তাকেও মুছে যেতে হয়। বাংলা সাহিত্যে দীর্ঘকাল বিবেকহীন বাস্তব বিমুখিতার সাধনা চলেছে, লেখকরা দেওয়ালের লেখা দেখেও দেখছেন না, ফলে সৎ পাঠকের মনে তাঁদেরও বিসর্জন ঘটছে। বহু সমস্যা, বহু অবিচার, বহু জাতি, বহু লোকাচার সম্বলিত দেশের লেখকরা লেখার উপাদান দেশ ও মানুষ থেকে পান না, এর চেয়ে বিস্ময়কর কি হতে পারে? মানুষের প্রতি এ ধরনের চূড়ান্ত উন্নাসিকতা সম্ভবত ভারতবর্ষের মতো আধা ঔপনিবেশিক আধা সামন্ততান্ত্রিক বৈদেশিক শোষণে অভ্যস্ত দেশের পক্ষেই সম্ভব। শহরেই কি মুক্তি আছে? বেকার সমস্যা ক্রমবর্ধমান, দ্রব্যমূল্য আকাশ ছোঁয়া, শিক্ষায় চূড়ান্ত নৈরাজ্য, এতে মধ্যবিত্ত ভারসাম্য হারাচ্ছে, প্রবল ধাক্কায় চলে যাচ্ছে অন্য শ্রেণীর দিকে, শ্রেণী সংগ্রামের ক্ষেত্র স্পষ্টতর হচ্ছে। ইতিহাসের এই সন্ধি লগ্নে একজন দায়িত্ববান লেখকের কলম ধরতেই হয় শোষিতের সপক্ষে, অন্যথায় ইতিহাস তাকে ক্ষমা করে না। কেন লেখা তা বলা হলো, সম্ভবত এবার ঘরের কথাও কিছু বলা দরকার। আমার লেখায় চিহ্নিত রাজনীতি খোঁজা নিরর্থক, শোষিত ও নির্যাতিত মানুষ তাদের প্রতি সংবেদী মানুষই আমার লেখায় প্রধান ভূমিকায়। বসাই টুডুর গল্পের কালী সাঁতরা সিপিএম দলভুক্ত এবং বসাই টুডু স্বয়ং নকশাল আন্দোলনকেও ছাড়িয়ে যায়। আবার দ্রৌপদী গল্পের নায়িকা আদিবাসী নকশাল কর্মী, মানসিকতায় এরা কোথাও এক এবং সেই একই ভবন আমার কাছে স্ববিরোধী নয়। জীবন অঙ্ক নয় এবং রাজনীতির জন্য মানুষ নয়, মানুষের স্বাধিকারে বাঁচার দাবিতে সার্থক করাই সকল রাজনীতির লক্ষ্য হওয়া উচিত বলে আমার বিশ্বাস। আমি বর্তমান সমাজ ব্যবস্থার বদলে আকাঙ্ক্ষিত নিছক দলীয় রাজনীতিতে বিশ্বাসী নই। স্বাধীনতার 31 বছরে 1978 আমি অন্ন, জল, জমি, ঋণ, বেট বেগারি কোনটি থেকে দেশের মানুষকে মুক্তি পেতে দেখলাম না, যে ব্যবস্থা এই মুক্তি দিল না তার বিরুদ্ধে নিরঞ্জন শুভ্র সূর্য সমান ক্রোধই আমার সকল লেখার প্রেরণা। দক্ষিণে বামে সকল দলই সাধারণ মানুষকে প্রদত্ত প্রতিশ্রুতি পালনে ব্যর্থ হয়েছে বলে আমার বিশ্বাস। আমার জীবনকালে এ বিশ্বাস বদলাবার কারণ ঘটবে বলে আশা নেই, তাই সাধ্যমত মানুষের কথাই লিখে গেলাম। নিজের মুখোমুখি হতে যেন লজ্জা না পাই সেজন্য, কেননা লেখক জীবনকালেই শেষ বিচারে উপনীত হন এবং উত্তর দেবার দায় থেকেই যায়। ফ্রম হিয়ার মহাশ্বেতা দেবীর পারপাস বিহাইন্ড রাইটিং দ্রৌপদী বিকামস ভেরি ক্লিয়ার। দিস মাস্ট বি কেপ্ট ইন মাইন্ড ওয়াইল ট্রান্সলেটিং দ্য টেক্সট। The change that she wanted was that in the lives of those who had been marginalized by force down the ages. Having spent a long time in the company of the Adivasis, abandoning her family and her service as a teacher in the Department of English in Vijayagarh College from 1964 to 1984, she had closely observed their entire condition in the contemporary times, in the mid-20th century. She used her talent for writing in creating narratives about them. Draupadi is one of her much anthologized stories. Every time one reads it, one is amazed by the manner in which the narrative is built, symmetrically structured like a three-dimensional model of a pyramid with three tiers. She has taken care to include all the external elements which were significant in the 1970s. Some of them are the War of Liberation in East Pakistan, resulting in the emergence of Bangladesh in 1971, and the role of India in it, particularly West Bengal. The Naxalite movement, the feudal practices, and the casteist social structure. Where does Dopti Majin feature in all these massive, unbending, and interlinked superstructures? Added to all these is her name, after Draupadi, of the great epic, with all its implications thrust upon her as a baby Adivasi girl by the wife of the man she later allegedly murders, since he was an exploiter of the poor sections of society. When we meet her, she is a widow with no one to call her own. Dopti Majin, unlike the Draupadi of the epic, poor, undernourished, with lice in her hair, with no heroes around her for good or bad, and much more. But like Draupadi, she has an undaunted spirit, that of a woman who is aware of being one and proud too. The author has taken great care to bring to the reader Draupadi's case. She has always had a respectful approach to the ability of the so-called underprivileged persons to fight or struggle against all odds. The deprivation meted out to Draupadi from all quarters, instead of converging upon her in order to erase her existence, is thrown back by her at the perpetrators of state-sponsored violence. Her story, thus, has multiple aspects and implications. She remains an absconding, alienated, impoverished woman until the violation of her womanhood in a vividly repulsive fashion by the upholders of the Indian Penal Code. But Dopti Majin does justice to her name in the last of the three sections of the story. No longer in the Dapur Jug to expect Krishna to provide her with fold after fold of Vastra, the Adivasi Dopti of Kaliyug knows how to retaliate, having nothing more to lose. For her, the Hrita Vastra need not be used anymore. She tears her sari into pieces with her teeth. Her tormentors, all men in government employment and protectors of the Indian Penal Code, by implication, have been accustomed to, quote unquote, preparing women under arrest who are completely distraught in the aftermath of the cyclone that rages over their bodies and minds. Therefore, Mahasheta Devi has Hardokti turn their own tables on the manly men in the culminating section of her story, Draupadi. Now I come to translating the story and my experience about it. Translating Draupadi from the source language to English as the target language is not a challenge. It is a coursework. Today, I shall share my experience of translating Draupadi. It was in 2018. I was invited by the director, Professor Shobhita Pradhan, of the Center of Excellence, Department of Odia, Vishwabharati, Shantiniketan, to be a part in one of their translation workshops. It was a week-long affair. Each one of the participants was given a text to translate. The source languages involved were Bengali and Odia. The target languages were Bengali, English, and Odia. Professor Pradhan, very gentle and soft-spoken, but very firm, personally gave us our, assignments. I was given Mahasheta Devi's Draupadi to translate to English. The work had to be completed in a week's time and handed over to Professor Pradhan before the workshop ended, and I left the very place which had a special impress on Mahasheta Devi, a place where she had studied. I knew a few things about this story. Number one, that it was widely read, much anthologized, very impressive, if I may use the word. Number two, Professor Gayatri Chakraborty Spivak had translated it to English with the consent and approval of the author. Number three, the story itself has, as I have already said, so many aspects. How would I go about completing the assignment given to me? So, I set certain parameters for myself. First, I would not read Professor Chakraborty's translation before I had brought some shape to mine, lest I get influenced by her excellent work. Second, I would obviously keep rereading the original text until I had imbibed it sufficiently to begin the work of translating it. While translating, one has to face a few factors. One, the narrative style of the author. Two, the tempo of the narrative. Three, the cultural milieu of the story. Four, and the cultural milieu of the target language. As in all translation works, there are certain sections which can be translated easily. There are others which can be translated with some effort. There are yet others which simply refuse to be translated. The third kind comprises the most culture-specific sections. These are so exclusive signifiers of a particular culture that they cannot be transplanted in another culture without explanations. One could put in end notes, but the smoothness of the texture of the narrative in the original tends to get lost in the process, and the subsequent linguistic communication therefore encounters hurdles. Now to return to the four factors I was speaking about. Number one, the narrative style of the author. In Mahasheta Devi's case, as always in her writing, it is very direct, sometimes using coarse or even impolite terms not commonly used by those she is speaking against, the more sophisticated authors or even many of the target readers of the story. So obviously, the narrative is going to deliver a jolt to the readers, and that is precisely her intention. Number two, the tempo of the narrative. Very brisk momentum, which increases as the story proceeds, rising to a height in the final section. That also has to be kept in the translation. Number three, the cultural milieu of the story. Those who speak Bengali are the readers of the story. But Dhopti Mejen is not Bengali. She is Santali. So the entire affair is pretty complex. And that of the target language, it is completely different from either Bengali or Santali. So therefore, that is the third, the second cultural element that has to be kept in mind. So I will now come to a few, rather five instances of translating from the original, where I will read from Mahashweta Devi's text first and then read Gayatri Madam's translation followed by mine. The first one. Bohumutro baro bhatari tar ek bhatar anxiety. Look at the language. Gayatri Madam writes, diabetes has 12 husbands, among them anxiety. I translated, diabetes is polyandrous, one of her 12 husbands, diabetes. Second instance, Mahashweta Devi, Karon Dibidho, Gayatri Madam, two sorts of reasons. I translate, causes dual. Number three. এবং একই সঙ্গে তিনিও শেক্সপিয়ারের মতো তরুণের হাতে পৃথিবীর লেগাসি তুলে দেওয়াতে বিশ্বাসী তিনিও প্রসপেরো গায়ত্রী ম্যাডাম এন্ড অ্যাট দ্য সেম টাইম হি লাইক শেক্সপিয়ার বিলিভস ইন ডেলিভারিং দ্য ওয়ার্ল্ডস লেগাসি ইন টু ইউথস হ্যান্ডস হি ইজ প্রসপেরো অ্যাজ ওয়েল আই ট্রান্সলেট এন্ড অ্যাট দ্য সেম টাইম হি টু লাইক শেক্সপিয়ার believes in handing over the legacy of the world to the youth. He too is prospero. Fourth instance, Samosya Bharsha Hoy. Gayatri Madam, the problem is thus solved. I write, the hitch clears. The last one, Oti Prashashoner Nitambe Dushto Pora. Gayatri Madam, it is a carbuncle on the government's backside. I translate, it is a body pustule on the administration's palms. For me, it was a coursework. Learning to transfer the matrix of one linguistic narrative to another. With a piece like Draupadi, it is an enriching experience. Written by one of the foremost authors of the 20th century and translated by one of the foremost theorists of subaltern studies. I shall conclude by reading the final section from the original and the English translation I tried to make of it. Chardike che Draupadi raktamakha thuthu khelte senanayoker sada bushakti beche nay ebong shekhane thuthu phele bole এটা কেউ পুরুষ নাই যে লাজ করব তারপর মরে পড়াতে দিব না আর কি করবি লে কাউন্টার কর লে কাউন্টার কর দ্রৌপদী দুই মর্দিত স্তনে সেনা নায়ককে ঠেলতে থাকে এবং এই প্রথম সেনা নায়ক নিরস্ত্র টার্গেটের সামনে দাঁড়াতে ভয় পান ভীষণ ভয় Draupadi looks in the four quarters, choosing the white bush shirt of the army chief to throw her blood-boltered spit, and throwing it there, says, there is no man here to make me ashamed. I won't let you clothe me. What will you do next? Go on, counter me. Go on, counter me. Draupadi's two mauled breasts keep on pushing the army chief, and for the first time, the army chief is scared to stand in front of an unarmed target. Terribly scared. Thank you. Madam Sanjoyita, I have finished.
Hello, madam.
Yes.
Okay. Thank you very much, madam. if anyone has any question, please you can forward your questions through chat box. Madam has already completed her description. If anyone has any question, please come up. Students and participants. Okay. All right. I think, madam, no one has any question. Thank you. Thank you very much for I'm extremely overwhelmed with the kind of comments I'm getting throughout the session. It was an extremely I am on behalf of students, I'm extremely privileged, madam, for having you among us. Thank you very much for joining.
Before I finish, I think I'll say one more thing. This is on behalf of the Paschim Bongo Kiriya Sabhar Kollan Samiti. If now or in future anybody is eager to carry out any research or any kind of study on the Kheria Sabhar community, you are most welcome to the Paschim Bongo Kheria Sabhar Kollan Samiti in Rajnoagar. There is a guest house there too, and we would love to have you there with us. I am a member of the committee. Thank you.
Okay. Thank you very much, madam. Thank you. Prashanto?
Yes. Hello.
Students of Prashanto, would you like to talk to madam or ask anything? Okay.
We don't have any other questions from the participants?
No, no.
Oh, it's
not
okay.
Yet.
Okay. I have talked to NGM sir and he has told me that he will join within 12 o'clock.
So what shall I do?
We have in between we have 15 minutes time at least. And ma'am, Jolly ma'am, I have an observation, and
yes.
Actually my observation is that you have translated the text Draupadi from Bengali to English, and
yes.
There is another translation is always obviously there by Gayatri Chakraborty Spivak. Madam, the dilemma of the translator, which is always prevalent while translating a text, that is, it is either agonizing or it is ecstatic. I want to know your experience while translating the text.
As I told you, there was no agony in translating Draupadi, frankly, for two reasons. One is personal, the other is that as a translator. I'll talk about the experience as a translator first, and then I'll come to the personal one, which is very minor. The text itself is so unique because of its content and because of its form and its language, that getting the privilege of being invited to translate such a text, and later on I was told by Professor Pradhan that it was the most difficult text that they had, of the ones they had collected. It was my privilege actually that she had given it to me, because the more I read the text closely, I had read it before and I was enamored of the character of Draupadi, Draupadi Majan rather, because if I put myself in her place, which most readers will as they read the story, what she does is exceptionally brave, bold, and unprecedented. Even in that kind of a situation, the way in which she retaliated, instead of breaking down as was expected by her tormentors, the way in which she behaved is portrayed by the ending of the story, and that actually leaves it open-ended. Open-ended in the sense that you might wonder as to what happens next. But for women, it is open-ended because they are invited to emulate Dokti Mejen's example. Women who belong to her community and women who belong to the so-called urbanized, sophisticated domains of Indian society that is also there. So translating the text, you know, every time I made a draft, I felt that it wasn't good enough to meet the kind of verve that was embedded in the text. That had to be brought in. That power, that force, which Mahashweta Devi was putting into her narrative, her particular kind of language, that was there. Now, whenever I read Mahashweta Devi's Bangla, I always feel that it is my Bangla, simply because I studied in a school where the Oxford edition of her primer, Anandapath, was used as the Bangla learning text, both for language and for literature. So her kind of Bangla, which again is influenced quite a lot by her parents and Rabindranath Tagore, was the Bangla to which I am accustomed. So there, you know, I had this kind of a feeling that this was the language in which I am very comfortable. So that is a personal experience. Therefore, the two put together were, of course, a very, very enlightening experience. I never claim again to be equal to Gayatri Madam. That is, like, frankly, out of fear of being influenced by her rendering, I tried to stay away from it until I had put mine to some shape. But mine is my understanding of Draupadi. Hers is her understanding of Draupadi. So where I am happy, but I am not satisfied, I admit. No translator, I think, will be satisfied with a work of translation. You come back to it. Now, if I get back to Draupadi, there are places which I would have to polish up a bit. And I really had a lot of trouble with the ending because I had to carry it to that climax to which Mahashweta Devi had taken it. And it took me a long time, actually nearly 2 full days, to just finish the section which I have read out to you.
Thank you, madam. I will try to read your translation also, which I have not read.
Oh, mine is available in Ethnic Tapestry, which is one of the publications of the Center of Excellence, Department of Oriya.
Okay, thank you, madam.
Okay. Some Prashad Malik was asking how to get ma'am's translation, madam.
So that's in Ethnic Tapestry and it's available in the Department of Oriya, Vishwabharati, Shantiniketan. Then I found a question in the chat box asking whether which is easier, translation or interpretation. Obviously interpretation, because you use your own language and you put in your own understanding of the text and then you give one perspective of the text. Now for Draupadi, every time an individual reads it, there will be a different interpretation. So you can understand, every time different people read it, there will be different interpretations. And obviously, as we all know, that an interpretation is always dependent upon the background, which is both experience, knowledge of an individual. So from my background, my interpretation of Draupadi will be of one sort. A man's interpretation will be of another sort. An Adivasi woman's interpretation will be very encouraging, because still today, Adivasi women, most of them are not empowered in the way in which they should have been. So that is still there.
Okay, thank you, madam. Madam, we have one more question from Pradeep Singh Jwala. He is asking that what is the difference and similarities between the two characters, one from Mahashweta Devi's Draupadi or Dapti, and the other is Mahabharata's Draupadi. The similarities and the differences.
I have just mentioned them in passing. The differences are many, but they are all social differences. The differences are social differences. Draupadi was born into a royal family, but she never had a childhood. She was born an adult out of the yagya flames. So that's why she has an equivalent name. But she had five men to protect her. Although the way in which they reacted in that famous Vastra Haran scene is also there, where incompetence or incapability had been later explained again in that explanation mode. But what they did has gone down into documentation. That is still there. Draupadi did not give up. And this Vastra Haran episode is actually one of the cornerstones of the Battle of Kurukshetra, to which the epic was gradually building. That is also there. This undaunted spirit of Draupadi's is also to be found in Draupadi Majin. She is poor, she is marginalized, she doesn't have much support. In turn, she supports the Naxalites who are in their hideouts by passing on different kinds of information to them. They depend on her. She does not depend on them. And she also knows from hearsay the kind of end that may wait for her and the things that she would do in order to protect the Naxalites with whom she was at one, and in order to end her life in the most respectable fashion. But none of these things happened to her. So that is Draupadi Majin, absolutely on her own, absolutely cornered. But the way in which she lashes back is something which makes her one with Draupadi of Mahabharata. That is what I have found. So the title of the story, I think, is both symbolic and adequate.
Okay, thank you, madam. There is one more question from our student, Sushmita Panda. She wants to know about subalternity. What is subaltern? If you have already mentioned, but still, once again, if you can, what is discuss the subaltern voice in Mahashweta Devi Draupadi. This is her question.
That is more of an answer that is being sought, and I think I won't go into the details of actually taking a class on an answer. But of course, there is the subaltern, because Gayatri Madam herself has an essay on the subaltern, which is highly theoretical in nature. She refers to Foucault, she refers to Derrida, she refers to Said, she refers to her own subaltern group in that very long essay, Can the Subaltern Speak? And she comes to the conclusion that the subaltern has a difficulty of communicating in the language of those who give the subaltern the status of subaltern to a typical, say, shobor lady, or I shall call her a woman. I am also a woman. To a typical shobor woman with very little or no education, when I go to speak to her in her home, who is the marginalized? Am I the marginalized? Or is she the marginalized? So that again is relative. When I go to her home, I am the outsider. I am the peripheral who has come and who will leave. She is the one in charge. She is the mistress of her own home. So then, when I go to speak to her, I will have to speak to her on her terms, in the language she understands, in order to communicate with her. Particularly as a researcher, if any of you have gone on field survey, you will find that you have to make yourself communicable with those on whom you are carrying out the field study. Otherwise, you will not be able to get the material, excuse me, or the data you intend to gather. Therefore, I have always felt, this is one place, that first of all, the subaltern has to be, there has to be a naming, so subaltern is fine. But whether the subaltern can speak, yes, they can. They cannot speak your language, but they speak their own language. And this has been proven by another person, this is a small digression. Girish Karnad, who in his play boiled beans on toast, and in his play Wedding Album, uses some characters who are servants in the households of the main characters. And very interestingly, he portrays these people who are serving in the houses as ones who control certain elements in the housekeeping, in the home management of those who think they are very important. And these people have their own language, have their own mode of communication, which the so-called quote-unquote mainstream persons are unable to understand. And therefore, this incapacity puts them into many difficult positions in the course of the narrative. They are befooled by the so-called marginalized, by the so-called subaltern. Therefore, the subaltern can speak. It has its own language. That language may not always be linguistic. It might be behavioral. It might be through action. Like in the case of Dobby Major, what does she say? Counter me. Now this term counter is what she uses for what her tormentors called encounter. And because this is a story based on the Naxalite background, you know very well now, it has been documented that many Naxalites, young men particularly, had been encountered and killed, murdered by those persons who had been appointed by the administration in order to eliminate this very strong anti-administration movement. So, when she says, counter me, she is challenging that one modus operandi which her tormentors consider the best method, and that is to encounter her. She knows that she may be encountered, and that is why she says, come on, encounter me. But when you encounter me, you are going to encounter somebody on whom you have acted in a way which goes against that very penal code which you are trying to protect and uphold. She does not understand so much of this. But what she knows is that her undaunted spirit, because of generations of oppression and deprivation, she has learned that there will be very little change to her situation if those like her do not rise against that kind of an oppression that has been meted out to them for generation after generation. So, actually, she does not have any other way but to retaliate in this fashion. That is also true. So, that is the status of the subaltern. The subaltern refuses to be at the receiving end any longer. And Mahashweta Devi, as I have read out from the introduction to Agni Garbho, has made a very pertinent point that she is going to write about this refusal to accept any kind of oppression and maltreatment of any nature.
Okay, thank you, madam. So the subaltern can really speak if we can hear them as Gayatri Chakravarti speaks. Our next, we have a few more questions, madam. Our ex-student, Saurabh Pal, who is now a student of Vidyasagar University, your student also, was mine, but now you're, he's asking a question. Please discuss the negative capability in the character of Sena Nayaka. Negative capability in character of Sena Nayaka.
I would like to ask Saurabh about what he understands by negative capability.
Saurabh, are you there?
Saurabh, are you there? What is your understanding of negative capability?
Unmute yourself, Saurabh, if you are present here. Saurabh Pal.
Hi, yes, ma'am.
Yes, what do you understand by show of negative capability?
Ma'am, negative capability in this very short story that we observe that Sena Nayaka is Synanak has controls the gap between theory and inner practical life. Theoretical, he wants to gain the culture of the inhabitants where he is involved in his task, and otherwise, in the other way, that we observe that Synanak has destroyed. Synanak want to destroy here Dhrupadi. I think there is the dual identity of Synanak.
It is not a dual identity. In fact, the character of Senanayak was based upon the then, it is presumed, commissioner of police of the Kolkata police, whose modus operandi was identical as his. He says something very significant in Draupadi. In order to destroy the enemy, become one. He says that. And that is the crux of the argument to, rather the answer to your question. In order to destroy the enemy, become one. That is why he makes a very close study of the cultural milieu of the people, particularly around Bakuli. He makes a very close study. He already knew a lot about the Naxalites. And because he is a Senanayak, you know, he is straight back from the Bangladesh war. And because India, particularly the Bengalis, were very successful in the Bangladesh War of Independence, he was very complacent. He boasted a lot about his ability, in contrast to that of Arjun Singh, who is this diabetic man, and who is a diabetic. One of the reasons for his diabetes is his continuous anxiety. So he wants to prove that he is complacent. He has everything in control, and he knows what he wants. He wants a good meal. He wants a good promotion. He wants a reputation as a very successful man in his position. And in order to reach that position, to keep that identification as a very successful man, he will go to any extreme. And one of those extremes is to study the enemy, become one, to understand what the next move of the enemy would be like, so that the enemy can be intercepted and eliminated. Eliminating the enemy is much a necessity as out of fear, because you know the Naxalites in the late 1960s and early 1970s were really a terror for those who were perpetrators of all kinds of oppression and all kinds of torture, all kinds of terror, which were directly or indirectly supported by the government at that time. And they were very scared of the Naxalites, because the Naxalites in the beginning were very organized and they were very intelligent, their leaders. They knew what they wanted, they knew how to get at it, and therefore those in the administration knew that they had to be equal to them in order to eliminate them. Dhrupadi Menon is intelligent, but she is uneducated, and she has been so oppressed that she is very brave. Therefore, she is a very difficult target, and that has been proven further by the ways in which she has escaped arrest, escaped interception in the past. So this time, a very tricky mode had to be resorted to in order to get to her. The Senanayak thinks that he is successful when she is intercepted and arrested. And that is why, out of his complacence, you see in the final section, different time frames are given very precisely, that this is time for his dinner. And he tells his men, prepare her, and goes away. And how was she prepared? Like a toad or any specimen of an animal on a dissection tray. The hands and feet were pinned down, and she was prepared until she passed out. and when her consciousness returned, she knew what had happened to her. But her spirit could not be suppressed in any manner. So the Shenanayak may have, as you say, his negative capability, but his negative capability is negated by Dobdi in front and Vasheda Devi in the background.
Okay. Chorav, have you got your answer? I think you have got your answer. There is one more question from Madam Biltu Khan, who was once a guest teacher, who served as a guest teacher for several years in a college, and now has been appointed as assistant professor in Government Vivekananda College, Mahiyar, Madhya Pradesh. Biltu Khan, thank you very much for registering with us, first of all. And second, your question, I would like to read out your question. Ma'am, in this story by Devi or Mahashweta Devi, the protagonist is not saved by any male, but we observe a significant departure in the treatment of character of Draupadi in Mahabharata. Kindly explain. So he is asking about the departure. Again, the differences, I think.
No, I have mentioned it. First of all, congratulations for your getting a permanent placement outside the state. And there is one point I'd like to make. Even in some of the YouTube posts, I find Mahashweta Devi is by mistake referred to as Devi. Now, Devi is not her title, her surname. It is not even her title. Her surname could have been either Ghatak or Bhattacharya. But she refuses to use a surname again because that is a patriarchal attachment which she likes to do away with. So her Devi status came to her after she wrote about Birsa Munda in what is the name of the novel? Aranyer Odhikar, Rights of the Forest. After that, the Mundari people, and she got her Sahitya Academy Award for writing Aranyer Odhikar, and the Adivasis were so overwhelmed, they had a 1 month long fair to celebrate this, and they thought that she was that goddess for them who could go out and speak on their behalf, and this Devi got attached to her name since then. So you could either call her Mahashweta Devi, or even Mahashweta would be fine, but Devi I think is a bit problematic. All right, now for the role of the men. I told you in Dapur Jug, where the Mahabharata is located, the Ramayana is in Satya Jug, the Mahabharata is in Dapur Jug, and according to that the chronology of jugs, we are in the Kali Jug with the COVID ransacking the entire world and us having no Vishnu or Ram or any other avatar of Vishnu to save us. Draupadi had, or rather Dobdi Majan's case is similar. Draupadi had Krishna in the background, providing her yarns and yarns of vastra. I use the term vastra because a piece of cloth becomes vastra when it is used to cover a person's body. And that vastra then becomes the signifier of chastity, of respect. But when that vastra is rita, when it is horon, then what happens? Is the chastity gone? So the vastra becomes a social signifier of chastity. But to Dobdi Majan, her chastity is internalized. Her physique could be distorted by a band of men who are not manly. If they wanted to ravish her, they could have let her free and then attempted to ravish her. But they did not have the courage to do that either. They tied her hands and feet so that to poles, so that she couldn't move. And then they did what they did. So this Dobdi Majan is more than the Draupadi of the Mahabharata, if you look at her that way. Because her mettle not to surrender has no support from anyone outside, neither her Naxalite comrades who tell her that if you are caught, no one will come to save you. You have to fend for yourself at that point of time. and she decides to bite her tongue off. She doesn't get the opportunity. So compared to Draupadi, the Kaliyug Draupadi Mejen, I would say, is a more dauntless spirit for that man, the Senanayak, whose complacency is absolutely shattered by this one woman whom he had failed to interpret.
Okay, Biltu, are you there? Mr. Biltu Khan, would you like to ask anything? Mr. Biltu Khan? No, I think he's...
I see one of my very respected colleagues over here. Suddenly I discovered Dr. Devdas Roy.
Devdas Roy.
Yes,
I specially invited him. I am honored also by his presence. I invited him specially to be here. He is one of my motivators and I am thankful.
Would Devdas like to say something?
Devdas, sir? Sir, please present yourself. Madam wants to talk to you and we all want to hear from you.
I am having some... Am I audible, madam?
Yes, sir.
During your talk, you held us in enthrall. Really engaging and meaningful. I listened to your talk, grabbed attention. I from the bottom of my heart, I thank you. My words are getting echoed, perhaps.
Yes, a bit.
Yes. Sorry for that.
Biltu, please unmute yourself.
Hello.
Yes, now I can hear you.
Yes.
Sir, please continue.
Hello?
Hello? Yes.
Yes, ma'am, it was really a pleasure to listen to you. But I don't know why is it happening, you know, my words are getting echoed and re-echoed.
No, now we can hear you clearly, sir.
Oh, yes, you can hear me clearly, but in my system, words are getting echoed. So, ma'am, I enjoyed your talk. It was a great talk and I didn't know that you translated it yourself. What Professor Gayatri Chakravarti Spivak had done, you have also have done. So I would like to read the text you have translated, your translated text, and that would be a pleasurable experience for me.
Thank you, sir. I'll make it available for you.
And thank you, Sanchaita, and your department for such a nice arrangement. And the madam has complied, and your principal, sir, I congratulate you on this meaningful arrangement.
Thank you very much, sir. Thank you for being with us. Thank you very much. Madam, initially we had no questions, but now we are overwhelmed with questions again. I would like to take a few more minutes of your...
Yes, please, please.
Madam, there is one more question. Just since you have already translated a version of Mashweta Devi's Draupadi, but what were the difficulties? Our question is, what will be the primary difficulty as a translator while translating any text?
Okay, I have spoken about it, that there are three, I divide a text into three sections. There is one section which can be very easily translated, you have no problem. There is another section which you may have certain difficulties in translating, but then again you can manage. But there are certain sections which are simply untranslatable. And these are very culture-specific sections. And there are some which I took by way of examples to show you how it is. যে পশ্চাতে দুষ্ট খোড়া সেটা কি করে ইংরেজিতে ট্রান্সলেট করবে? Will it be carbuncle or will it be pustule? Will the পশ্চাত, given the kind of attitude Mahashweta Devi has and given the kind of language she herself used, আমরা সবাই জানি যে উনি খুব সরি ফর দি ল্যাঙ্গুয়েজ কিন্তু খিস্তি গালাগাল দিয়ে কথা বলতেন, উনি বিড়ি খেতেন, সো শি লাইক টু সাবস্ক্রাইব টু দি আদিবাসী ওয়ে অফ লাইফ, শি ওয়াজ নট ইন্টারেস্টেড ইন প্রুভিং হারসেলফ সফিস্টিকেটেড। তাহলে এই পশ্চাৎ দেশটিকে আমরা কি ব্যাকসাইড বলবো না বাম্পস বলবো? বাম্পস কথাটা কিন্তু খুব চলিত, সো ইন দিস কেস আই প্রিফার টু ইউজ বাম্পস বিকজ আই ফাউন্ড ইট synchronous with the attitude of the narrative. So these are things which you have to decide upon and sometimes maybe just stop, wait, think over and then come to a decision of your own. So these are the things that one does. And the kind of cultural milieu that the text is trying to represent will actually indicate the kind of word that you can choose from the thesaurus or the synonyms which you have at your disposal.
Okay. All right, madam. Madam, one more question is that, as we know that you have already mentioned that she is definitely a voice of the subaltern, she is definitely a voice of a kind, she is not only a voice of Bengal, or I am talking about Dabdi Mejhan, she is not only voice of Bengal, but does she represent any, I mean, Mahashweta Devi's translation or Mahashweta Devi's work, or what is her role as an Indian feminist, her contribution?
As an Indian feminist?
Yes, there is a question from Prasad Malik. Importance of Mahashweta Devi as an Indian feminist.
I have an understanding of Mahashweta Devi. She is more of a humanist, a person who works for human beings of all kinds, rather than a feminist per se. What she believes in is freedom of independence, and that is one of the reasons for her walking out of her marriage with Bijan Bhattacharya, because she felt that in spite of all his leftist affiliations and social vibes that Bijan Babu was giving out in his personal life and his domestic domain, Mahashweta Devi was not accorded the kind of freedom that she deserved or expected, so she walked out. She believed in the freedom of human beings. She believed in the freedom of every individual, the freedom of women. Now, since women were the most oppressed of the two broad genders, she wrote more about women because they were more oppressed, not because she was out and out a feminist. Now, since she wrote more about the more oppressed of the two genders among the underprivileged, she may be interpreted as a feminist author. She has no issues about that, but that was not her primary target. Her primary target has been clarified very well in that introduction to the story she included in Ogni Garbha. That is why I read out from there. It's a very short introduction, but a very significant one. And this text is available on the net, thanks to COVID, in archive.org. You can download it right now.
Okay. I would request all of you, to all the participants, to download original text and read it out. Madam, I have a question. I personally have a question. Since I am teaching this in my college, this has been assigned to me. Okay. So, yes. My student didn't read the Bengali version, the original version. So, what should I do? Should I refer them to read the Bengali one first, or just go
through? Definitely. They read the Bengali version first, because with all due respect to Professor Spiva, somewhere I found that there is a certain amount of finesse in her version of the translation. Particularly, I think because she was translating for a Western readership, she did not go into that kind of crudity that is there in the original text. So that crudeness is required for an understanding of what Draupadi does in the end. If she did not have that, she would not be able to do it. And therefore, reading the original text is a must if one can access Bangla. And reading the introduction to Agni Garbo is also a must in order to understand Draupadi very well.
Okay. Thank you, madam. I will definitely suggest that.
Thank you. And I appreciate your venture of teaching Draupadi.
Thank you very much, madam. I'm just a novice. It's been 3 years only of mine as a teacher in this college and in my life also. Madam, one more question. She was again my student and now your student, Munna Roy. She was a brilliant student. And I think she is now also a brilliant student. She has asked a question, ma'am. Then we can say that Draupadi Mejhan is a symbol of subaltern defiance. I think you have already answered the question.
Yes, I have answered. If you yes.
Subaltern defiance defines the same associated with rape and sexual abuse. She has mentioned the term rape and sexual abuse.
Sexual abuse, I think, would be again a term for the sophisticated. And what happened to Draupadi? Rather, Draupadi Mejhan was the worst kind of rape that can happen to a woman. But in most cases, these raped women do not have any platform for redressal. Who is going to listen to them? Because those who are arresting her are the ones who are raping her. Who will listen to her? And who will go against them? So there is no redressal possible. Draupadi Mejhan, therefore, does what she does. That is the only thing that she can do. So that is there. So this way in which she reacts to the next morning's behavior towards her is definitely a retaliation on her part as a representative of all those victims upon those who victimize women like her. That is there. Of course, it is a retaliation. It is rare, but it is possible.
Yes. Madam, I do believe, as Draupadi says, that it is you can never rape a body until we allow anyone to do it. It is always rape of the mind. If we yes. decide to be strong enough, that cannot be rape of the body.
Yes.
Body is same.
I have,
can be
yes,
male
body
can
is the same.
Female.
That is why I told you that the cyclone which rages over the body and the mind, most women are distraught by it. But Draupadi could not be put down by the manhandling and deforming of her body and her genitals and her breasts, which are the signifiers of womanhood. She had been badly manhandled. I think my words are insufficient to express what had happened to her, but her mind remained undaunted. You're absolutely correct.
Yes. Madam, one more question. This is, I think, a kind of just, it can give us some comic relief also. If you translate the work once again, would it be different? What is the translator's view?
As I said, now if I get back to it, maybe I will improve on it. Because given the kind of narrative which Mahashweta Devi had put into her story, I have not been able to reach up to that level. So maybe I will try to get closer if I am to translate it
again. Okay. Every time we translate a text, it becomes a new one. And that is why it may be called, it may be called a transcreation also.
Transcreation, yes. Even I prefer to call it a transcreation. Girish Karnad also called his works transcreation. Because he was the author who wrote in Kannada and translated them himself. And he always said that, okay, by general terms, you can call it translation. But I said, sir, what should it be? I had connections with him. I asked him, sir, what should it be? Should it be translation or transcreation? He said, translation is a better term. Because when you, again, transfer from one language to another, what happened in his case was that, I'm digressing, but this is again a generalization. We have so many different kinds of dialects. Like in Draupadi also, there among the two Uttipara lok in the beginning, one is a typical Bangal and the other is a non-Bangal, which you can make out from their dialogue. But when you put it in English, it becomes flat because you can't use Cockney or any other dialect for that matter. So it is in flat English. A lot of that flavor is lost in the translation. What do you do? So it is translation.
Yes, and one more question from Aniket Das. Dakti suffers the physicality of a body from powerlessness into powerful resistance by the end. As we know, he converts herself into the male mindset, and he represents herself as a powerful resistance. Is that the main connection between the F Draupadi or Shantal Draupadi, Dakti? Is that the main connection, the powerlessness of Draupadi and the powerful resistance of Dakti? Is it the only connection that Mahashweta Devi wants to link or wanted to link?
No, Draupadi in Mahabharata, yes. In Mahabharata, Draupadi was not powerless. She had other ways of manipulating, because remember, she was a princess. And she lived in a royal milieu, in that kind of a situation. And she uses more of diplomacy and politics, and you can say, what you find in Chanakya's Arthashastra to a certain extent is what Draupadi is using. She's very manipulative because she has 5 men to manipulate and another man behind her to support her, apart from others. There is Krishna's support and there are 5 Pandavas on whom she can exert her absolute control. And the one modus operandi would be to tell them, well, you did not protect me when I was in that Vastraharan affair, so now you'd better go about setting things right. And she made them do what she wanted to make them do. That is Draupadi of the Mahabharata. What she did in her position was as expected of her, but what Dakti legend did in her position was unexpected of her. She was finished, it was over for her, so she had to wear her sari and get back to the paraphernalia of the police affairs. But what she does is something unexpected, both by the reader as well as the characters in the story. So Dakti Mejen is unique. Draupadi as a princess has been manipulated, I repeat once again,
by the patriarchal society. Okay. Madam, last question is asked by one of our students, a present student of semester, Dohita Banerjee. See, Miss, I think you had mentioned something about diabetics.
Yes.
She wants you to explain the portion of diabetics in brief, once again. In brief, just in brief.
The thing is that I actually read out from the translations, and I said that there are 3 kinds of translation. But there are 2 kinds of translation of that section on diabetes. Mahashweta Devi has had a bit of unique humor in describing Arjun Singh's diabetes, where she says, Bahumutra baro bhatari, again, look at the language, tar ek bhatar anxiety. And I have translated, diabetes is polyandrous. Mujhe baro bhatari to ingriji te hai na? So diabetes is polyandrous, one of her 12 husbands' diabetes. That is how I translate it. And Gayatri Madam has, diabetes has 12 husbands, among them anxiety. So that is another very nice translation. Kono mohila ke satyi kotha bolte among the subaltern, quote unquote subaltern, kauke jodi ei bhatar shobdota byabohar kora hoy, so-called sophisticated elite samaj dhore na eta khub baje shobdo to shekhane du bhatar bola mane khub kharap kotha ar ekhane 12 bhatar bola hocche mane she worse than a prostitute to diabetes ke shei bhabe describe kora hocche je diabetes er onek gulo karon thake she hocche oi rokom mohilar moto. So this kind of an attitude, again, why is Mahashweta Devi using just this particular phrase? You can actually have a comment on this. And why is she using this term, Bahumutra Parobhatari, which shows that men are, as we all know, accustomed to cracking jokes based on sexuality, on sensuousness, and usually aligning them with womanhood or women. So this is another of those terms. So when she uses this term, what she is doing is, she is using you can say, a masculine mode of expression in order to give back to men what they will get at the end of the story. So that is also the gomutra barobhatari kothata beshirbhag chelerai bole ar kono meye jodi kono meyeke bole shetao take to motei somman kora hoy na ei gomutra ke thik shei bhabei dekha hocche. And poor Arjun Singh is into this kind of a disease.
Okay. Doita, have you got your answer? Doita Banerjee?
Okay.
Doita Banerjee?
Yes, okay. She has chatted. Madam, yes.
Okay, okay. I could not find. Madam, the session was mind-blowing, as I would like to read out one Aryan Sultan from university, a scholar in the University of Harvard is replying from there that my mind-blowing session, excellent presentation. And from my side also, I'd like to say, Madam, thank you very much for being with us. This was, the session was really excellent and enthralling.
Thank you so much. I am impressed. I am overwhelmed. And actually, I kept it short. Now I shall be frank. In order to have an interactive session, and I was feeling a bit crestfallen since there were no questions, but now I'm very happy.
Well, madam, this is first time. This is, I have already organized some seminars in my college, but this is for the first time that I'm conducting a webinar, online seminar, and this was a great opportunity for me to talk to
you,
with you.
Yes.
And madam, in future, I would like to have you among us in the college when the COVID, as you said, the COVID trauma.
Okay, we are just next door.
Madam, please
and
join.
Your,
then,
most importantly, your principal, again, I repeat, has been a wonderful colleague. So to go to his college would be a privilege for me.
Madam, definitely would like to have you. Thank you very much, madam. Okay, thank you. Prashanta, would you like to have any more, any other question do you have? Or just give a vote of thanks to madam?
Yes, okay, ma'am, as I have been informed already that ma'am is going through a busy schedule, and in spite of that busy schedule, she has accepted our invitation. It's a great pleasure of listening to you, ma'am. And I should not belittle your endeavor by saying merely thanks to you. You are above to be thanked. And my heartfelt gratitude to you. And as our next speaker has already joined with us, I request, ma'am, if possible, please be with us. And in near future, we look forward to listening to you more, ma'am. Thanks a lot, ma'am.
I shall join by way of my mobile phone so that I can hear while I am doing some work.
Oh, thank you. Thanks a lot,
no
ma'am.
Problem. Just be with us. Just be with us. Please be with us.
It's okay.
Thank you. Thank you. So it's time for us to move. It's time for us to move to our next session. So as we know, we had two lectures back to back. This is a series of lectures. At present, we have organized two. First of all was first and foremost one was by Dr. Jolly Das, the head of Vidyashagar University. And we are extremely privileged. We were to have her with us, and to we are honored with her presence and presentations. And now we have among us Dr. Nadugopal Mukherjee from Bankura Christian College, reader, Bankura Christian College in the Department of English. Sir, I welcome you on behalf of the department and the college. I welcome you to this program. Thank you very much for being with us. And I'd like to request Prashanto to give a brief introduction regarding sir and begin the next session.
Thanks, ma'am, for giving me this opportunity to introduce Dr. Nadugopal Mukherjee. He is my direct teacher, and he has helped me in several ways. Dr. Nadugopal Mukherjee is the Department of English, Bankura Christian College, has 21 years of teaching experience in his college. He was awarded PhD in Applied Linguistics in 2007. He undertook a UGC MRP on metaphysical poetry. Dr. Mukherjee acted as a resource person in different national and international seminars. He presented papers in International Conference on Conrad in South Africa in 2011, when I was a student of Bankura Christian College, and on Shakespeare in 10th World Shakespeare Congress in UK in 2016. His research articles have been published by Routledge in 2013 and Conrad Society of Poland in their journal in 2017. He has been a regular reviewer of ISLE, Oxford University Journal. He has been a PhD supervisor and also an adjudicator. He will be speaking on Things Fall Apart, a post-colonial reading, which is included in our fifth semester English Honours syllabus. In this pandemic situation, when each and everyone are falling apart, I think this text is very, very important. And I hope that all the participants will be very much pleased to hear his lecture, as I can still remember his lectures of my college days. His voice is still echoing in my ears. And that's why I request, sir, please go on with your lecture. Sir, please start your lecture.
Thank you, Prashantu, for your generous introduction, which I am not really, which I really do not deserve. And thank you also, Sanchoita, and also the college authority present, to invite me as a resource person on this day for this particular webinar meant mainly for the students. And keeping in mind the needs of the students, I will definitely address my lecture. As Prashantu said, that it is really very a tough time. We are going through a very tough time now because things have really fallen apart and things are really at random. Things are really in a chaotic order right now because of this pandemic. I am now addressing the screen of my laptop and I don't find my students on the other side. I don't find the audience also on the other side, the other people. And this is a very tough situation, a very critical, a very difficult situation for everyone to cope up with this kind of situation and to carry on with academic enterprises. Still, we have no other alternative to carry on with this kind of exercise. And accordingly, Prashantu has invited me, Sanchoita has invited me. I am really thankful, grateful to both of them and also to the other faculty members, the younger ones, quite young to me. And I am also thankful to the college principal for extending his invitation to me, considering me as capable of addressing the students of his college. Anyway, thank you all. And with these words, now I would like to go directly into the topic that I'm supposed to discuss today. Things Fall Apart, a post-colonial reading. This is definitely a cliche topic. There have been so many researches, so many articles upon this particular subject. And so I'm not going to say anything new here because I must keep in mind that I'm addressing my students. Students of Gorbeta College or students of Bankura Christian College, all are after all students. And keeping in mind their needs and their intelligibility, their comprehensibility, I will try to restrict myself. First of all, you have to know what post-colonialism, that particular term, means. And then you have to understand why or Chinua Achebe wrote Things Fall Apart, with what particular objective, with what particular goal in mind. That is what you have to understand, and that is what I will be discussing later on. So this is actually the format. In the first part of my discussion, I will be mainly discussing several aspects of post-colonialism, which I am sorry to say is not really possible to discuss in this limited frame of time. However, I will try to touch upon the central issues, the main issues, and I don't know, and I know that thousands of those aspects will remain untouched, unaddressed in my lecture, because post-colonialism is a term which is really very difficult to understand and also very difficult to explain, and also very difficult to cover every aspect of that particular term or theory. So within this time frame, within this limited time corpus, it is really not expected that I would be able to do justice to this particular term or the theory. And in the second part also, Things Fall Apart is a major text, a seminal text, which also demands a lot of time. And again, I'm afraid I really can't do justice to the text. So please bear with me, please cooperate with me. If so many important things are dropped, or so many important aspects remain unaddressed, untouched in my lecture. Anyway, let me go directly to the PowerPoint presentation that I have prepared for you, for, of course, for the intelligibility, for better understanding, clear understanding of the students mainly. Please bear with me just a few seconds. So this is my topic, as I said, Things Fall Apart, a Postcolonial Reading, written by the African writer Chinua Achebe. Only very recently he died, only 7 years back. These are the parts of my discussion. First of all, I would be discussing the term, the theory of postcolonialism and the theory of postcolonialism. I will also try to refer to some theorists and then Chinua Achebe's postcolonial position and how, keeping in mind that particular postcolonial position, Chinua Achebe wrote this novel, Things Fall Apart. And of course, the post-colonial issues that we find in the novel. As you find in Patricia Woh's book, Literary Theory and Criticism, Oxford University Press, the term post-colonialism addresses to the historical, political, cultural, and textual ramifications of the colonial encounter between the West and the non-West, dating from the 16th century to the present time. That means the post-colonialism basically addresses this encounter between the West and the non-West. And I will later tell you how the West has been traditionally considered as always superior to the non-West. So starting from the 16th century, rather late 15th century, when colonization started, when imperialism all started along with colonialism, and how it has gradually developed through the ages, how the very concept of colonization has gradually developed through the ages, and what exactly happened in the 20th century, and now what we are facing in the 21st century. This is actually, I will try to trace the development, the evolution of post-colonialism through the ages, starting from late 15th and early 16th century till this time. Postcolonialism, as you find in the very first point, relates to historical, political, cultural, textual ramifications of the colonial encounter. So, second point, postcolonial criticism is effective at helping us see the connections among all the domains of our experience, psychological, ideological, social, political, intellectual, aesthetic, as Tyson says in Critical Theory Today. So look, postcolonialism does not really mean something specialized or any specific aspect of studies. Rather, postcolonialism is an umbrella term, an all-inclusive term, which has within its coverage every aspect of studies these days. Psychological studies, ideological studies, social studies, political studies, intellectual studies, and also aesthetic studies. And postcolonial theory offers us a framework for examining the similarities among all critical theories that deal with human operation. So postcolonialism addresses mainly this aspect, the history of exploitation, the history of oppression, as Marxism does, as feminism does, as queer theory does, I must tell you here, I have to hide the lowermost tool here. And there is also a problem in hiding that. If I get disconnected, I won't be able to trace out that. That means I won't be able to find out whether I am there on the virtual platform or I have got connected. So please remind me through WhatsApp, Prashantu, if I get disconnected. I am hiding the tool here. Okay, for your understanding, for the understanding of the students, all the points. As I was saying, postcolonial theory offers us a framework for examining all the similarities existing among different critical theories that have come up in the last few decades, like Marxism, feminism, queer theory, African-American theory, lesbian criticism, gay criticism, and so on. All these theories, or all these branches of literary theory, all these branches of philosophy deal with different levels of oppression, different levels of exploitation, different levels of dehumanization, exploitation. Postcolonialism speaks of that dehumanization, that subjugation, oppression, marginalization, othering of human beings by some other people. And this othering, this marginalization, that comes to us in different forms. And there are so many theories to address all these levels of exploitation, all these levels of marginalization or subjugation, whatever you say. So Marxism addresses that. Feminism also addresses that history of exploitation from a different perspective. The gay people, the lesbians, the queer theorists, they also speak of exploitation. The feminists, the eco-feminists, eco-linguists, also they have spoken of different levels of exploitation. And so in African-American theory also we find, African-American studies also, we find that history of exploitation. Just a brief, brief looking back, reminiscence or recollection of what we found in the history starting from the late 15th century. Spain, France, England, Portugal, you all know, and the Netherlands, they started plundering the natural and human resources of the African as well as the Asian countries in different times. During the 19th century, Britain emerged as the largest imperial power, and we know that India came directly under British regime, British authority, British rule during that time. And by the turn of the 20th century, the British Empire ruled one quarter of the Earth's surface. Can you imagine? One quarter of the Earth's surface, one fourth of the Earth's surface, including, of course, India, Australia, New Zealand, Canada, Ireland, and also Africa, West Indies, South American countries, Middle East, Southeast Asia, and so on. That means in so many countries throughout the world, across the globe, the British people could exert their authority in one quarter of the Earth's surface. And so British colonization was the major colonization in the 19th century. And since in all these colonies, British people, the rulers, the colonizers, spoke in English, wrote in English, used in English, English gradually replaced the native cultural traditions, native linguistic traditions. And even when they left those countries and the countries got liberated, like India in 1947, they left behind them the residual effect of colonial domination, what we know as colonial legacy. That means even when they have left behind them certain legacies to be carried forward. For example, right now I'm speaking in English, and I'm a teacher of English, and you are the students of English honors or English PG, whatever you are. And that means we are continuing with that colonial legacy. In fact, the dynamic psychological and social interplay between what ex-colonial populations consider their native indigenous post-pre-colonial cultures and the British culture that was imposed on them constitutes a large portion of the field of study for post-colonial critics. That means this is basically post-colonialism, a dynamic psychological and social interplay between the native indigenous pre-colonial cultures and the British culture that was imposed upon them either in the 18th century or in the 19th century or in the 20th century, early 20th century. So this is basically the area, the conflict, the encounter, the interplay between native indigenous pre-colonial cultures and the colonial cultures. That is what the post-colonialists address. Even when the colonizers left the countries like India or Nigeria in 1946, all such countries, you know, African countries, Asian countries, when they left those countries and the countries got liberated, attained their freedom, still cultural colonization continued. That means British culture, British values, British system of education, British system of government continued. Even our constitution, Indian constitution, that you all know, the constitution makers, the draft committee, based Indian constitution mainly upon the British constitution. So this is again cultural colonization, which is still continuing. So our primary concern here would be to find out how post-colonial criticism understands the political, social, cultural, psychological equations between, or the encounters between colonialist and the anti-colonialist ideologies. Those who were earlier in favor of colonization, colonialism, and those who are now after the several countries had got their freedom, after they had attained their freedom, how they have been reacting to that colonial aggression at one point of time. A good deal of post-colonial criticism addresses the problem of cultural identity. That means these people, the people these days, are now addressing, or rather dealing with, this issue of cultural identity. That means whether we are capable enough to assert our own identity, to establish our own cultural identity, or we are just continuing with that colonial tradition. Colonialist ideology is that the Western people, the Western colonizers, all the time considered themselves to be superior when contrasted with the native people, the indigenous people. They always considered themselves to be superior because they thought that they had new science, they knew technology, they knew philosophy, they knew the recent developments in different branches of study, and so theirs was a superior culture, theirs was a superior language, and theirs was a superior style of life. They believed that their culture was metropolitan culture, whereas the culture of the native people was savage, backward, undeveloped. And that's why they were pushed to the margin, whereas the British colonizers considered themselves to be all the time at the center. So center margin encounter is the thrust of post-colonialism. We find the post-colonial theorists to be speaking of how the colonizers or the historians of different times, the philosophers of colonial times, the historiographers, the historians, the sociologists, theologists, all of them, how the writers, all of them have all the time established their culture as a superior culture. You know, in The Tempest, William Shakespeare's The Tempest, those who know that particular text. However, the students, most of them have not yet gone through that text, I know that. But in The Tempest, for example, Caliban is all the time represented as inferior, savage, as uncivilized, barbaric, primitive, guided by his instincts. Whereas Prospero kind of people, the white people, consider themselves as superior at the center. Prospero is there at the center. Caliban is there at the margin. The Eurocentric world in colonial times always considered themselves, the Eurocentric people always considered themselves to be there at the center, and the non-Europeans, rather I would say non-Westerns, at the margin. And so they othered, marginalized such people, such indigenous people, such natives as the Indians were. So this othering means considering the other people as non-human kind of creatures and considering themselves as wild, beastly, savage, and putting them into the margin. That is known as othering. So othering was found in colonial times. The savage is usually considered evil, as inferior. That means the demonic other, or sometimes we find in some colonial texts, the texts written by the white people, by the white writers, by the colonial writers, they have represented the savage people, the natives, either as demonic other or exotic other. That means either they have considered these, the natives, as savage, demons, or they have considered them as primitive. No, they have considered them as primitive beauty or nobility born of a closeness to nature, exotic other. So whether demonic other or exotic other, whether they are considered as inferior or they are considered as very close to nature and so beautiful, in either ways, these native people were always considered not as fully human. This attitude is known as Eurocentrism. And Eurocentric people all the time claim that their literature is universal, their philosophy is universal, their ideas are universal. For example, we say sometimes that Shakespeare's texts are canonical texts. Wordsworth's poems, Keats's poems are all canonical poems. So whatever has been produced by those famous writers of different times, the white writers, whether English writers or French writers or German writers or say Spanish writers, those writings have always been considered as universal writings, having some universal appeal in them. So whether Shakespeare's Macbeth or Hamlet or The Tempest is applicable to our time or not, we don't really go into that discussion. We always believe that they are all universal writings, and even now they are applicable. We don't really question their applicability, their inclusion in our syllabus, because we believe that those are canonical texts, some standard texts, some classics, and so nobody should question the applicability of those classics. the very language that they use, the Eurocentric people, the colonizers, they have categorized different countries of the world into four categories, as you find here: first world countries, second world countries, third world countries, and fourth world countries. Look the language. First world countries: Britain, United States, and some European nations like France, Germany, Spain, Netherlands. They consider themselves to be first world countries, superior to all others. First, ranking first. Then come the second world countries, countries like Australia, New Zealand, Canada, South Africa, which are thought to be not so developed as the first world countries, but they are also very close to the first world countries, and their language is now officially English language. Their culture is now English culture. And so Australian culture or New Zealandian culture or say South African culture, that is very close to first world cultures. Third world countries, the countries like, India, the Asian, South Asian countries, third world countries, and the fourth world countries, that means the countries, the aboriginals, or the aboriginals or the indigenous people, the ethnic people, the tribal people, those who have been traditionally, conventionally suppressed, repressed. So this kind of categorization of the countries into four different kinds or types, that is again something political. They had definitely in mind a particular politics to consider them as superior compared to the natives, the savages, the indigenous people, the ethnic people, or the colonized people. Another example of Eurocentrism we find in the term Orientalism, where Edward Said, a very famous name as a theorist, and you will be studying Edward Said at the post-graduation level. Edward Said, in his book Orientalism, spoke of this politics, this Eurocentrism. The very term Orientalism is a product of these people, those who consider themselves to be superior to the other people. They all the time consider themselves to be superior to the Eastern nations or African nations, Asian or African nations. So the Chinese, the Arabians, the Asians, the Middle East people, all these people are considered as cruel, sneaky, evil, cunning, dishonest, given to sexual promiscuity and perversion, and so on. Whereas they are always very sophisticated, always very cultured, civilized, polite. So that sort of division is made. And they have devised, constructed this very politics of Orientalism. The very term, they actually make a difference between Orientalism and Occidentalism. They create certain binaries between Orientalism and Occidentalism. And thereby they claim that they are superior to the Oriental people. So when we devise a term like, say, black, we want to say they are black people compared to us who are white. So look, black, evil, cruel, such terms have been devised in all kinds of political discourses or colonial discourses by those colonizers, just to differentiate them from the colonized people. If you go to Mary Shelley's Frankenstein, I don't know whether it is in your syllabus, but it is in our syllabus, how you will find how Mary Shelley's Frankenstein is saved from prison by the white man, the Lacy, the European, whom the Arab subsequently betrays. That means the Arabians, the Asian people, are known for their betrayal, for their conspiracy, for their intrigues, whereas the white people are there all the time to save the others. They are the great saviors. Citizens of the West define themselves in contrast to the imaginary Oriental, as Edward Said said. That this very concept, Oriental, is something imaginary. It is concocted, it is constructed by them just to make a difference between the Orientals and the Occidentals. Just to suggest that they are very kind, straightforward, upright, honest, moral, and so on. And that is this very concept, Oriental, is an invention of the West, as Edward Said said in Orientalism. Postcolonial theorists like Edward Said address those issues of Orientalism, issues of margin-center conflict, issues of Eurocentrism, universalism, or grabbing something, labeling something, considering something as canonical, universal, and so on. Postcolonial theorists describe the colonial subject as having a double consciousness or double vision. That means a consciousness or a way of perceiving the world that is divided between two antagonistic cultures, that of the colonizer and that of the indigenous community. For example, this double consciousness you find in everyone, whether in your department or elsewhere. This double consciousness, double vision of the people. On the one hand, you see the savages, no, so-called savage people, so-called native people. They consider their culture to be inferior culture. And they also look up to the Western culture as a better culture. And they try to cope up with that culture. What we are doing every day, what you are doing every day, that double vision, double consciousness is present. On the one hand, you start hating, expressing your contempt for your own culture, your indigenous culture. On the other hand, you look up to the Western culture, the colonial culture, as something great, as something to be imitated, as something to be followed. Double consciousness often produced an unstable sense of self, and that led to forced migration. That means, you know, some of us or maybe our relatives, our near and dear ones are now settled down, have got settled in different Western countries, either the USA, US, United States, or maybe UK, or maybe in some other European countries, or maybe in Canada. And their descendants gradually start forgetting all about the original nationhood or original national identity of their parents. And this is what we discuss in diaspora literature, how diasporic people who either voluntarily went to different countries or those who were forced to go to different countries to earn livelihood. Those diasporic people have always this kind of consciousness or double vision, suffer from this kind of double vision, double consciousness. They start hating their own culture and start looking up to the Western culture as something superior. This feeling of caught between two cultures, what the diasporic people get caught. You know, the diasporic people get caught between two cultures. As you find in the short stories of Jhumpa Lahiri, for example. As you find in the writings of Anita Desai, for example. In all these writings, or in the writings of, you say, Salman Rushdie, in the writings of Amitabh Ghosh, in the writings of Upamanyu Chatterjee or Rohinton Mistry, you find these people, the diasporic people, how they speak of this getting caught between two cultures. And it has been referred to by Homi Bhabha and the others as unhomeliness. Bhumi Bhabha is another name who is very known, very famous for his theory of nationalism. But I don't know how far I can discuss that. So this unhomeliness, this diaspora feeling, this double vision is another aspect of post-colonialism. That means post-colonialism addresses these issues also. There have been two different terms, as you find here, neo-colonialism and cultural imperialism. That means these are again the products of the colonial, colonial aggressors, colonial theorists. How, even after their departure from the Asian countries or the African countries or the Latin American countries, even after that, they have left behind them certain puppet governments. Those who all the time blindly follow the US government or maybe the UK government or that kind of government. Certain puppet regimes, puppet authority, who will all the time be guided by those Western people, those governments, those people in the government, that kind of puppet regimes. This has been left behind even after these countries have got their independence. And that is again known as cultural imperialism. As you find, this is actually a direct result of economic domination. Food, clothing, customs, recreation, values, all these are being dominated by that dominant culture. So even after your honest intentions to look back to your own country, to look back to your own cultural history, your traditions, conventions, you can't really get rid of the colonial legacy or cultural imperialism. Now those Europeans or maybe the US people, or even in Asia, you find the Chinese people, they are gradually dominating the market. So whether you go for food or clothing or customs or recreation, all the time you look up to them, either China or the US products or the Chinese products or maybe the European products. And that way, cultural imperialism has always its say, even after all these African or Asian or Latin American countries have got their independence. The post-colonial critics, these are only some of the critics. Of course, there are so many others like Benedict and Anderson, Partho Chatterjee, all are there. I'm not going into all those details right now because I have still an important part of discussing Things Fall Apart. I have already referred to Edward Said and Bhumi Bhabha, Fanon, Spivak, Bill Ashcroft. Bill Ashcroft is very known for that very famous book, The Empire Writes Back. So I will come to that later on. That is actually Bill Ashcroft, the Australian writer, has been a major exponent of post-colonial theory. I'm sorry, I can't really discuss all these because I have to skip some of them. I now move into the text. And while discussing the text, I will go back to those theorists, Fanon or Spivak, or maybe Bhumi Bhabha, or Edward Said, some of them. The title, Things Fall Apart, has been, you all know perhaps, at least the fifth semester students know, the title has been taken from W. E. Yeats's famous poem, The Second Coming. Perhaps you are now studying that poem also in your fifth semester syllabus. And in the third line of that poem, you see here, things fall apart. The center cannot hold. As your sir, Prasanta sir, was saying earlier when he was introducing me, that we are now in a situation where really things have fallen apart and the center cannot hold. Things are going to the worst extremes. Mere anarchy is loosed upon the world. So what Yeats thought of almost 100 years back, because of the immediate political background, the kind of violence that he had witnessed in the last decade before he wrote this poem, in 1917, 1916, 1919, also the First World War, all these incidents he had come across during that time, keeping in mind all those incidents of violence, he wrote this poem, and he, through this poem, he wanted to say that Jesus Christ was about to be reborn in the form of a violent creature who would bring an end to this age, to the old age, and a new age is about to set in, about to start. So that was the early 20th century, he thought, was a transition period between one age that was coming to an end and the other age that was about to start. And Jesus Christ would take another birth right at that time to herald that new age, to announce the arrival of that new age. Because things were not really going in the right direction at that time, W.B. Yeats thought so, in the wake of what he, no, in the context of what he found in his country in Ireland, in the context of what he found in Europe, in the context of what he found in world politics at that time. He thought things were not in the right, rather falling apart, getting decentralized. Now, J.M. Coetzee, African, he has been a Nobel laureate also a few years back. In his Elizabeth Costello, that Elizabeth interprets, the English novel is written in the first place by English people for English people. The Russian novel is written by Russian for Russians, but the African novel is not written by Africans for Africans. Rather, African novels have been written by the Europeans. For example, Heart of Darkness by Joseph Conrad. Joseph Conrad was a Polish writer, though wrote in English later on. From Poland. And he wrote that novel on Africa. That means a white writer, a European writer, was writing on Africa. J.M. Coetzee refers to that. African novelists may write about Africa, about African experiences, but they are glancing over their shoulder all the time as they write at the foreigners who will read them. Whether they like it or not, they have assumed the role of the interpreter, interpreting Africa to the world. That means African novelists write about Africa, about African experiences, but they are actually assuming the role of the interpreters, interpreting Africa to the world through English language, not through African language. But English writers write in English. The Russian novelists write either in Russian language or in English language. But African novels mostly have been written by the non-African writers, or even if they have been written by African writers, they have been written in English, not in the original African languages, because maybe the writers like Chinua Achebe wanted to reach a wider audience and to project to the whole world that Africans were not really savages, not really beastly people, wild people, as the white colonizers had always thought of them. And in this respect, Chinua Achebe is the founding figure in the contemporary African novel, since his novels signify a clear breakthrough with the colonial tradition in Africa. Achebe wrote at a time when decolonization had already taken place. That means Nigeria had already become a liberated country, had already got its freedom. So Chinua Achebe wrote at a time when Nigeria had already become a liberated country, decolonized, had already been decolonized. Achebe comments here, I have indicated somewhat offhandedly that the national literature of Nigeria and of many other countries of Europe, Africa is or will be written in English, unfortunately, although. This is definitely a controversial statement. That means the literature of Nigeria will be written in English. And so is the case with the other countries. The writers of the other African countries will also write in English, very paradoxically, not in their native languages. Achebe, through English language as the medium of expression, has challenged the Western cultural superiority, the kind of empire writing back in the language of Bill Ashcroft, the Australian writer and a major exponent of post-colonialism. Like him, Achebe also writes back, means he writes in English but gives a fitting reply to the English people or to the colonizers or maybe to the Western people through his writing. Achebe has re-explored the African experiences and the history of their suffering, their pain, their African cultural identity. In Things Fall Apart, Achebe describes a serious conflict between Christianity, advent of Christianity, means the advent of Christian missionaries, the advent of the European people in their land, brought by the whites, the influences of Christianity brought by the whites, and how those Christian ideas, the missionary ideas, or the ideas of the white people were in conflict with the African traditions, the indigenous traditions. Achebe in the novel presents the pre-colonial state of the Igbo society, the society that is narrated in Things Fall Apart, the Igbo community, the Nigerian community, within a very simple style, in a very simple language, English language, although he expresses that pre-colonial state, means before the arrival of the Christian missionaries, what sort of culture, what sort of tradition, what sort of social history they had, social structure they followed, what sort of judicial system they had, what sort of rules and regulations were followed in their culture. Chinua Achebe discusses all those aspects of the indigenous cultural tradition in his novel Things Fall Apart. But the language that he has chosen is English language. But here also we find some kind of post-colonial reply, response to the traditional, conventional colonization of the language, of language or linguistic politics. That means, though he writes in English, you will find so many words if you go through the text, so many Nigerian expressions to be used, and also folk tales, myths, oral traditions, folk traditions, all these have been there incorporated into the text. And without any translation. Sometimes he has translated, sometimes he has not. And that means here there is a travesty of the canonical English. There is an upheaval of the traditional, conventional, canonical English. And in that sense, it is also a post-colonial reply to the colonial history of exploitation. as I said earlier, post-colonial literatures are primarily concerned with writing back to the center in a process of questioning and travesting colonial discourses. According to O'Reilly, when approaching a post-colonial text, the writer has an awareness of some key issues that include the use of indigenous cultural traditions. That means here Chinua Achebe is aware of all these indigenous cultural traditions. Then appropriation of English, that means modification of the English language. When he brings into the text, incorporates in the text some Nigerian expressions, Nigerian gods and goddesses, Nigerian folk traditions, actually he is reappropriating the English language, changing, modifying, revising the traditional English language and bringing certain modifications, revisions of the traditional English language, the language of the colonizers. He's bringing about certain revisions here. The controversy remains, why he goes for English language then? Why doesn't he write in his original language, Nigerian language? The answer I gave you earlier. And in fact, Chinua Achebe also gave in so many times, he himself gave an answer to that. That he wrote in English only to tell the people, the Western people, or maybe the global people, the global readers, that the African culture, the indigenous culture, is after all not a savage culture. The three principal issues, last point you find here, have been efficiently dealt with by Achebe in Things Fall Apart. The cultural issues, psychological issues, and political issues, as we find in Igbo Community. Of course, Achebe resorts to the English language as the medium of expression, and he does not mind writing in that language. And again, he was a convert. That means he had become a Christian. That means he imbibed Christianity, embraced Christianity, quite against the tradition of the country at that time. So many people were getting converted when he got converted, of course. But in Things Fall Apart, what he protests against in certain places, the undue, colonial aggression that was found among some colonizers, some missionaries also, that is what he protested. So in spite of being a Christian, he protested against that kind of colonial aggression, or that dehumanizing the African culture by the Western people who were found there in among the Igbo community, in as it has depicted in, as narrated in Things Fall Apart. There are so many things here which I'm sorry I can't discuss. I told you about Edward Said in the first point you find. Edward Said in his Orientalism said the fabricated Orient was a European invention, as I said earlier, fabricated, imagined, constructed. Orient and Occident, these concepts, Oriental, Occidental, Orientalism, Occidentalism, that kind of such binaries were the constructs of the fabrications of those European people. Chumiran Guha Mojumdar, the second point you find here, he refers to E.B. Tyler and says, an anthropologist E.B. Tyler, and says that Tyler writes in one place, the tourists, after reaching the impossible countries like Africa and seeing no police system available in those countries, came to the conclusion that cannibals live there as their wishes. That means in Heart of Darkness you also find, when the Belgian colonizers settled down in Congo Valley, they thought that those natives of the Congo Valley were uncivilized cannibals That means they ate the flesh of human beings. Something they could not really imagine. And they thought that it was the burden of the white people to civilize them. The burden of the white men. They thought it was their burden to civilize these people, as if they were so much civilized and these people were all cannibals. Fanon, another post-colonial critic, as I pointed out earlier, offers the same statement that for colonial, last point you will find here, this vast continent of Africa was the haunt of savages. That is what the colonizers thought, that all savages are here. A country riddled with superstitions and fanaticism, colonizers thought. That all superstitious people are here. As in Things Fall Apart, for example, you find so many superstitions. Chinua Achebe says that some of these superstitions are for the betterment of the people and some are abominable ones. Chinua Achebe takes a very neutral position here. All the time, he does not support all the superstitions, all the superstitious practices, all kinds of fanaticism that were found in his society, in his country. He did not support all of them. He supported definitely some of them, some of those cultural traditions, but also wanted to do away with some of them. And he thought that the Christian missionaries brought about definitely certain changes in that, in some respects, some positive, productive, constructive changes. Achebe has placed himself in line with what Said said. Things Fall Apart has become an anti-orientalist discourse, as Said's text is, as Said's theory is, an anti-orientalist discourse, after all, anti-orientalist discourse. And here in Things Fall Apart, Chinua Achebe gives an authentic depiction of the Igbo life. The life of the Igbo is romanticized, distorted by the Europeans. I told you earlier, you remember, the native people, the indigenous people, the original inhabitants of the colonized nations were either treated as demonic ones, demons, or exotic ones. Demonic other, exotic other. I used those two expressions as we find in Tyson's book, exotic other and demonic other. That means they were treated as exotic creatures, romantic creatures, as you find in the text like Chinua Achebe's Things Fall Apart, or they were treated as demonic ones. Chinua Achebe does not go into either any of the two, he does not represent either the demonic ones or the exotic ones like the colonizers. Rather, he very objectively, in some places, impartially depicts the Nigerian reality through that Igbo community. By presenting a post-colonial Igbo society, Achebe attempts to reclaim African history from an African perspective, though written in English. Achebe receives an early education in English, grew up surrounded by the complex fusion of Igbo traditions and the colonial legacy. That means when he was writing, it was a mixed culture, hybrid identity that he experienced. On the one hand, there were the Igbo traditions, the original traditions, and on the other hand, he was experiencing colonial changes or colonial modifications of their way of life. In his essay, named for Victoria, Queen of England, Achebe, Chinua Achebe, expresses his moral responsibility to go back to the past. He says that Things Fall Apart was an act of atonement with my past, a ritual return and homage of a prodigal son. That means I went back to the past. I brought back what was there in pre-colonial times. A return to the rituals, the practices, the traditions that were there in pre-colonial Nigeria, or to be very specific here in the novel, Igbo society. And it was a kind of atonement for him. That means he repented of his distancing himself from the African community, at least through his language, the language that he chose for his novels, or the religion that he chose, the Christian religion that he embraced. He wanted to go back to the past, to mark his homage, to mark his respect for the oral traditions, for the cultural traditions, for the great history that his country had. In another, this essay, the African writer and the English language, Achebe states that African literature should be defined as having the complexities of the African scene. One major purpose of his writing, second point, of writing this novel is writing back to the Europeans, as I was saying, the empire writes back now, writing back to the Europeans or the colonizers. Franz Fanon, the theorist, maintains that there was nothing to be ashamed of in the past. So when Chinua Achebe goes back to the past in Things Fall Apart and represents that Igbo community, he does not really feel sorry for that. Why should he be? There is nothing to be ashamed of that. There is nothing to be really sorry for that. But rather dignity, glory, solemnity, these are associated with that kind of looking back to the past. This optimism is shared by Achebe, who unearths the glorious past of Nigeria through this novel. That optimism. He champions the fact that there was nothing to be ashamed of in the language of Fano, in the pre-colonial past of the Igbo. Even knowing another post-colonial theorist and notes that anthropological reports on the Igbo were accomplished during the heydays of negative colonial practices. That means the colonial people gave negative impressions about Africa, about Nigerian people, or maybe about Congo people, about all the African countries, in fact. And all the perspectives of the African peoples, plural, all cultural groups, were treated in disdain, in contempt, in hatred by the colonizers. Chinua Achebe in Things Fall Apart gives us a native perspective, and the characters possess their own voice in the novel. Second point, as you find here, they speak of their values, their resourceful values, which were later crushed by colonialism when the Christian missionaries entered their villages. Okodo points to the relationship between the cultural performance and religion of the Igbo. He says, if the dramatic performances of Greek classical culture originated from ritual performances in honor of gods, as you all know, if you go back to the ancient times, ancient Greek culture, how the very concept of tragedy came up, we come to know that they sacrificed certain animals before the altar of Dionysus. They then danced around that altar, and that dance gradually took the shape of certain songs, which later again modified themselves and became tragedies, because tragedy comes from tragois, sacrifice. The very word tragedy comes from tragois, a sacrifice. Then the Greek tragedians, famous Athenian dramatists, Sophocles, Aeschylus, Euripides, all of them to be referred to by Aristotle in, you know, Poetics. all those Athenian dramatists, the great tragedians, they based their tragedies upon those age-old traditions. That means those rituals led to the emergence of tragedy as a concept, as a branch of literature, you can say, though oral literature. So if such rituals could lead to a kind of great literature, why should the African rituals be neglected? The performances of Igbo gods be rejected? That means they should also be given their due honor. Things fall apart, recreates an oral culture and then consciousness that exhibits, as Achebe says, African peoples did not hear of civilization for the first time from the Europeans. That means they had their own civilization, though it was not the kind of civilization that the colonizers projected as while referring to their civilization. Of course, not that kind of colonization, that kind of civilization. It was a different one, but definitely African peoples had their own concept of civilization. He does not represent the pre-colonial Africa, pre-colonial African Nigerian society, Igbo society, as a pastoral ideal. Rather, that means exotic other, he does not represent that kind of exotic setting. He does not depict that kind of exotic setting or exotic characters. Rather, he condemns certain activities of Okonkwo, the main character. He condemns some of his actions, and at the same time, he appreciates some of his actions in the novel Things Fall Apart. And thereby, Chinua Achebe takes a very objective kind of standpoint in some cases, in some instances. Prasanta, am I? I think I have spoken too much, and should I continue it?
Yes, sir. You can.
The students won't have any problem. What's the time now? It's 1:45.
1:40.
So Things Fall Apart recreates this oral culture, this consciousness. Basically, that was an agrarian way of life, agricultural based way of life. And these people were all engaged in agricultural activities. Chinua Achebe uses the English language, as I said, a foreign language, a colonial language. But Achebe feels that the English will be able to carry the weight of his African experience to the global people, to the people across the globe. He said, it will have to be a new English, still in communion with an ancestral home, but altered to suit its new African surroundings. That means new kind of English, revised form of language. And here we find that post-colonial reply response to the colonial representation of the English language or the English way of life or the English literature. In fact, he makes a creative modification of the English language. He represents a counter narrative to Eurocentric representation of Africa as done earlier in the novels on Africa by the African writers. We find in Things Fall Apart how the people of that village Umuofia, how they get scared when the missionaries gradually come forward and gradually dominate over their cultural practices, over their cultural traditions, and also over their rules and regulations, how their rules and regulations are gradually taken over by the Christian missionaries. And in Things Fall Apart, we see that advent of the colonial power and how the people of Umuofia, the village, how they face a great challenge to their purity, chastity, sanctity, their age-old practices, whatever be those practices, good or bad. Just a minute. The colonial masters bring with them, as we all know, different ideologies, different philosophies, different perspectives. And Chinua Achebe, by representing the Igbo community, by representing the community through Okonkwo and the others, he represents how these traditions should not be dehumanized, should not be considered as inferior, savage. There are certain things in their lives which should be appreciated. Anyway, I think I have to stop now. I would have continued had I been given time, but it is actually, no, it is already 1:45. And sorry for actually extending my time beyond the time frame that I was given. Okay, thank you for the day. And thank you for your patient hearing, Prashanto and Sanchayita. I'm sorry I could not really discuss the several aspects of the text, you know, because of the time constraint. And so, and excuse me this time.
Thank you, sir.
It's absolutely all right, sir. No problem. Okay, continue, Prashanto.
Thank you, sir, for delivering such a lucid and yet thought-provoking lecture. As always, with your mesmerizing voice, you have the capacity to capture the attention of the audience. And now I would like to take one or two questions which are there in our chat box. The first question is from Navanita Chakraborty. And she wants to know, sir, would you please explain how far Achebe is successful to break the notion of Eurocentrism in his novel, Things Fall Apart?
Thank you for the question. And he, you know, Achebe, he expresses his stance against his position against his, against Eurocentric way of life or Eurocentric culture, Eurocentric domination by representing the Nigerian community, by representing the Nigerian cultural traditions, even though he uses their language, the language of the colonizers. But he points out the one-sided treatment of, or rather, he criticizes, satirizes that very colonial interpretation of the African people. Have I been able to address the issue?
Yes, sir. Yes, sir. Thank you. I will move on to the next question. Saurabh Pal is asking how Africa is represented in Conrad's Heart of Darkness and how Achebe countered that image through his novel Things Fall Apart.
I just passingly touched, but I could not really go into the details. Even though we all know that Joseph Conrad in Heart of Darkness, he is critical of the colonizers, particularly the way they were hankering after money, they were hankering to ivory trade business. He represents the British colonizers, the Belgian colonizers, and also the European colonizers in general, as against the Africans. That means he is pro-African to some extent. He expresses his solidarity with the Africans, That is what Joseph Conrad does. But Chinua Achebe was not satisfied with that kind of representation of the Africans. He thought that even after his best efforts, the African people, after all, have been represented as savages. And that means Joseph Conrad has stuck to the tradition of colonialism. He has not really come out of that colonial policy, colonial politics. And Chinua Achebe was very much critical of Joseph Conrad.
Thank you, sir. Next question is, from Pradeep Singh Jala, how is the textual attitude of Western peoples towards Eastern culture in Orientalism? Kindly explain. I think you have already explained.
Attitude of Western peoples towards Eastern culture. This is what I referred to so many times.
Yes, yes, you have already
explained. Referring to Fanon's post-colonial position, the Algerian critic, or Edward Said's Orientalism, I referred to them. And I said that their attitude of the Western people has always been to dehumanize the non-Western people, the savages.
The next question is from Somukanti Mondol. As far as my knowledge is concerned, he is a PhD research scholar at Pondicherry University, and he is also an assistant professor at Government General Degree College, Gopivallapur. Okay. Thank you, Somo sir, for being with us and for asking this question. He has asked, in Decolonizing the Mind, Nogugi is renouncing English language as his medium of expression on the ground that one cannot express his or her ideas authentically in such a language which is not his or her own. Achebe, as you have already mentioned, does not subscribe to Nogugi's logic. Rather, in his 1964 essay that you have mentioned in a way has thanked European colonialism for uniting so many scattered African nations. Which of these two African stalwarts view do you agree?
Yeah, thank you, Somo, for asking such an interesting question. And Ngugi's writing in Decolonizing the Mind, yes, he has renounced English language as the medium of expression, and rightly said that, of course, it is his standpoint that English language is, after all, a language which cannot authentically reproduce the African cultural tradition. For example, in Indian context, if we say that a writer writing in English cannot really represent the Indian culture or Indian society, because the language is, after all, a foreign language, after all, a language of the colonizers. So how can one represent in the best possible way through a foreign language? Achebe, however, thought that English language could be his language to represent Africa to the global people, to the global leaders. And I would subscribe to this position of Achebe, because we know in the Indian context, I was saying, as referring to, there have been so many Indian writers who have been quite successful in representing India to the global leaders, very successfully. You know all those writers, Salman Rushdie, Amitav Ghosh, India-born writers, though some of them are settled down now, have settled down in some foreign countries, some Western countries, but of course they have been quite successful in representing India properly. Even though the language is a different language, not exactly an Indian language, original Indian language. So I would subscribe to the standpoint of Chinua Achebe. But it's up to the writer which language he will be choosing. The language does not matter in this, global connectivity. Language is not a problem. You can easily translate everything. Of course, all are not translatable. That is what we find in the theory of translation. I'm not going into that theory. That is a different discourse again, whether everything is translatable. But definitely, certain things are not translatable. So in that sense, Ngugi was right that English should not be the language for an African writer. But Chinua Achebe is again right in his position that English could be the language to reach to the global people, to the global audience or global readers. Okay, I actually can't really take any standpoint because standpoints vary from person to person. And this is an age of post-colonialism, post-structuralism. So you can't really stick to one particular position or standpoint. You have to be very much lenient, liberal, and you have to accept all the standpoints of all the writers. Okay, Somo, I don't know whether I have satisfied you.
I would like to tell you one more thing about Somukanti Mondal, Professor Somukanti Mondal. He is an ex-student of my college, and also he has worked here for a couple of months as a guest teacher in our college. And now he is a professor, as you know, of Government General Degree College. Thank you, Somukanti Mondal. Would you like to speak to sir or any other thing if you have any other queries? Thank you very much for being here.
Yeah, thank you, Somukanti, and thank you all those whom I can't mention here, their names I can't take here, everyone's name. But thank you for your patient hearing. You cooperated with me. In fact, I could not really discuss the major issues of the text. I have given you only a generalized view, overview, but I could not pick up really certain textual references for your better understanding, the students. For your clear understanding. Unfortunately, because of time constraint, because this is a text which can't be discussed within 20 or 30 minutes. Okay, so your teachers are there, Sanchoita is there, Prasanthi is there to discuss the text. Thank you.
Thank you very much, sir. Prasanthi? Hello, are you there,
Prasanthi? Yes. I think there is no more questions from the participants.
Okay.
This is the last question. Okay.
All right. Thank you very much, sir, for your inspiring speech. And it was really helpful for us as well as the students. And thank you again for being with us, for participating in our program. It was really helpful. Thank you very much. And now I'd like to invite Poulomi Saha, our guest, part-time teacher to your department, who has been recently appointed as that, to come up and deliver the vote of thanks. Poulomi, are you there?
Am I audible?
And a special thanks. And a special thanks to Mr. I can see Sir Arup sir is present here, head of Gwalior College, associate professor and head of Gwalior College. Arup sir, whom I had requested, and on my special request, he is with us till now. Thank you very much, sir, for being with us, for joining us, and for motivating us. Okay, Paul, please continue.
Just a minute. Arup has been my scholar also.
Arup sir, are you here? Arup sir? Sir, are you here? Can you hear me? Hello? Arup sir, can you hear me? Hello?
I think he is not here. He is not here.
I think he is not. He can't hear me. Okay, sir, you'd like to say something to sir?
Poulomi, sorry, I forgot to take your name. Poulomi, sorry, I really forgot to take your name. And thank you also for inviting me and for giving me the due honor. Thank you.
Thank you, sir. Poulomi. Okay, so. It's a great pleasure for me to be a part of this huge initiative. And during this period, it was a much needed initiative simply because we had been isolated from each other for a long time. And it is due to the progress of the technology that we have come together in such a platform. I, Poulomi Saha, faculty member in the Department of English, feel honored to deliver the vote of thanks. First of all, I am very much thankful to our Honorable Principal Sir, the chief patron of this webinar. Thank you so much, sir, for helping us to conduct this webinar. And without your constant support and unconditional help, it would not be feasible for us to arrange this webinar. And heartfelt thanks to our esteemed resource person, Jolly Ma'am, Dr. Jolly Das, Associate Professor and Head, Department of English, Vidyasagar University, and Narugopal Sir, Dr. Narugopal Mukherjee, Reader, Department of English, Bankura Christian College. First of all, thank you, ma'am, for accepting my request and delivering this engrossing lecture on Draupadi. Jolly ma'am is my direct teacher, and really today's lecture reminds me of her class in university, and literally her lecture has given me goosebumps, really. And thank you so much, Dr. Narugopal Mukherjee sir, for your thought-provoking lecture on Things Fall Apart, which inspires the students as well as us a lot. Thank you so much for enlightening us with your insightful deliberation. I would like to thank to the conveners of the webinar, Professor Sanchoita Manna ma'am, Assistant Professor and Head, Department of English, and Professor Prashanto Rokhit sir, Assistant Professor of our department, for arranging this enriching webinar within this period, short period of time. And I cannot help thanking other respected faculty members of this webinar, Mr. Tapan Kumar Rana sir, Mr. Pradeep Kumar Mahato sir, and Mr. Subhajit De sir. I am very much thankful to the advisory members, to Dr. Abhijit Banerjee sir, Associate Professor, Department of Mathematics, and Mr. Proloy Kumar Bhattacharya, Librarian of our college, for giving us the constant support and guidance in all positive way. I would also like to thank all the distinguished dignitaries, our students, research scholar, teachers, and other participants. We have in our mind of arranging such webinars in near future, and we look forward all of your active participation in our future events. Thank you all for joining. Thank you, everyone. Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you so much, Poulomi, and thank you, everyone, for participating in this program. Thank you, Prashant. Thank you, and a special thanks to our librarian, Mr. Proloy Kumar Bhattacharya. I just can't express my gratitude to you, Proloyda. It was all because of your support, endless support. I'm really sorry if I have bored you in any way, and would like to do it again, don't mind. So, and Abhijitda was sitting along with us for last 5 hours. Since 8:30 they had started the program, and just he had gone for having his lunch. So this was immense support we received from the college and our principal sir, worth mentioning. Obviously his wife is not well, still he had joined us on request. He told me yesterday that he cannot join, but still I requested, and I almost forced him to join. So it was all because of you. If we work together like this, we can go far ahead, you know. The department will have its own reputation in the coming days. We need to work together more. Thank you, and the students upon whose demand the inter program has been organized. Thank you very much. Hopefully we will organize this kind of programs again further. So looking forward to it. Thank you, everyone. So I'm closing this meeting hereafter. Thank you.